saving America one mind at a time. This is Smith Radio. And now, your hosts, Kerry and Brian Smith.
You know YouTube's gonna have field day with this one. Okay, for those of you who do not get this song or haven't heard this song before, or maybe some of you who are not big rock and roll fans, it's a tribute to Chris Cornell, who passed away this week. And this is one of my favorite songs that he did with audiosoave. It is a family-friendly show. It's all right. Don't you worry. I promise. Oh, so...
Do you think that'll pass muster with the Google censors?
I'm not sure, but it's really sad. Another rock and roller has unfortunately taken his life. He did a concert. Chris Cornell did a concert earlier this week. And right after the concert...
Nice. A little bit of an audio issue here. There we go.
Dude, that was YouTube.
Welcome to Smith Radio, by the way, in case you didn't know. This is your host, Kerry Smith and...
Brian Smith. Coming to you live every Sunday evening, 5 to 8 p.m. Eastern. If you want to be a part of the show, 513-888-1538. Follow us on Twitter, at Smith, S-M-Y-T-H, Radio, and also at Brian P, S-M-Y-T-H. I'm still hearing a buzz. Is that you?
Oh, that was you. Wow. We've got a lot of gremlins going on here in the studio. Whew. Got spaghetti roll wires all over the place. You just kind of got to kind of tap on them a little bit there. But anyway, special thanks to Steve McDaniels, who does our little intro in the beginning, the voiceover, which is awesome sauce.
Dude, that's those voiceovers that you're born with that. Either you're born with it or you just don't. Yeah, you just don't.
I'm thinking about putting my resume in for the what is it, the theater voiceover thing?
Yeah,
in a world, I'm ready to go.
This is military veteran talk radio. Kerry Smith served in the Marine Corps. I served in the Air Force, and we come at politics and with a different flavor and a different different feel for it. We love to expose the fake news, and there's a lot. Oh my! I don't know if this is the biggest week of fake news I have ever seen, but they are relentless. Stephen Molyneux. He made the comment that mainstream media news is failing. Cernovich had typed up an article and was talking about why mainstream media writes the articles they write, and the fact is that conservative people like you, like me, if you're listening to our show, you're most likely a conservative, and if you're not a conservative, a Tea Party member, a Trump lover, a drain the swamp kind of person, and if you're not that and you're listening to us for the first time, welcome aboard. It usually takes a little bit of, maybe a couple of shows to really get the feel for the show, how we come at this, but I promise you, you'll wind up loving it and understanding.
I've already resigned myself to just that people are going to have to listen to us a couple times to really get it because, you know, it's not like, I don't know, I'm not a natural comedian, but, you know, I think that I the way I interpret news and kind of digest it and then regurgitate it is a little bit unique, and it's so unique that I do think that it's an acquired taste. That's just my opinion. Yeah. So definitely want to go ahead and do that.
I agree 100%. And there's something about this. And Kerry and I have been doing this. We've been doing this, what we do on the show. The show was originally about us not really doing politics per se, but we would have these conversations on the phone for hours and hours on end. Don't worry, I'm not going to tell them what we talked about.
Yeah, please don't.
And I'm not going to show anybody. Nobody gets to see the memos either.
Okay.
No memos.
Because after the phone conversations were over, you went ahead and jotted down notes.
Oh, I sat down for
make sure.
hours.
Yeah. So that way you have a written record of it.
So I could remember what we talked about.
It becomes evidence in the court of trial.
So we would do this for hours and hours on end, and we would talk about this for years. Hey, we need to do a show. Technology caught up to what we needed. We went with Spreaker.
Yeah, you got to realize that when we were talking on the phone, there was nothing out there that where we could say, we should be doing this on what we're doing on the phone on this platform. It just didn't exist. This was before, like right now, you could just literally go live in video with your Periscope, and then you got your Facebook Live and you got your YouTube Live. We didn't even have Spreaker at the time. No. We were honestly thinking that we need to just record our conversations onto an audio file and then upload it to something for people to listen to. And it was just, we didn't know what we were going to do. And Brian just stumbled upon Spreaker when it was in its infancy, which was kind of interesting. Like, I never heard of it before ever. Nobody was on it, literally.
I scoured the net looking for a platform, and the only reason why I chose Spreaker, the misspelling of speaker,
Horrible branding.
But the guy who owns speaker.com lost out, man. Sorry, you should have got the misspellings too. Anywho, they offered an opportunity to get on iHeartRadio. And I thought, as we thought, well, we get on iHeart. Oh, we're rich. We're famous.
No. iHeart's a joke because it's for something specific. People listen to iHeart for, like, you know, if you want to listen to a radio station from your hometown from 500 miles away, iHeart's the perfect solution. And that's what people, I think, use it for. When I'm in Florida or when we went to DC, I could listen to the shows that I listen to on the radio here in Cincinnati there through iHeart.
Right. Hey, they're talking about hashtag Smith memo. Made some comment about lists and lists on Twitter. What are some of the lists that you...
you want me to... Okay,
Carrie's a mess. We're going to get into the news, folks. We're going to get into the news of the week. What we do here on Smith Radio is we sum up the week. We tell you what they didn't tell you. We explain it all. We tell you what the fake news is. And Friday, Saturday, Sunday is where they hide the tidbits, the nuggets of information, the pieces of gold that they plant on purpose on Friday, Saturday, Sunday because you'll miss it because that's just the way it is. We're busy on the weekend with our friends and our family. And so when you listen to Smith Radio on Sunday night, you'll get the wrap up. So when you get back to work Monday morning, you'll know what's going on. So what are our list on Twitter?
So I've been on Twitter for far too long. And if you didn't know, in case you haven't actually explored your app, Twitter has this really stupid, pointless, useless feature called lists. And I don't know exactly what they were thinking when they made this, but you can create a list for yourself that you could attach to other users on Twitter, and then they would all be under this file of yours. The dumb thing is when you add somebody to a list, it notifies them you added them to this list, which is perfect for a troll like me. Because I want people to see what lists I'm adding them to.
It's so bad that people will put in the title, their name, and then what they're about. Will block all lists. No lists.
Yes.
Will block.
That's very common. You'll see that a lot. I will block you if you put me on a list. So here is a list of lists that I put together. And this wasn't all at once. This is over a long period of time. This is what it accumulated. So it's in alphabetical order. So we'll go down the list in alphabetical order. The very first one is called Adds People to Stupid Lists.
Okay.
That is the list I'll put you in if you put me in a list.
Oh, okay.
I don't even need to block you. I'm just going to put you in my Adds People to Stupid Lists list. The second one is Against Free Speech. These are, you know, your Antifa people that are going to blast you for being against free speech. You know, self-explanatory. I have one called Allows Democrats to Win. That was what I would attach to all the never Trumpers, the people who are claiming to be conservative during the primaries and during the general election, who were just totally never Trumper, so I would put allows Democrats win. Believes the magic of atheism. That is obviously not really politically, and you know, that's more for people who believe in atheism and think that evolution is true, which requires magic. I mean, it's a long story. We can get into that for 2 hours, but it takes magic for evolution to work. And if you're an atheist, you have to believe the magic of evolution. So I'll add you to that list if you're into that conversation. Here's a good one. You'll love this. And we had a discussion about this with people on Your Voice Radio and some other people too. Some of these people have hundreds of thousands of followers.
Right.
They're in media.
Right.
They can't get a blue check from Twitter. They won't give it to them. They'll deny them.
We haven't been given our blue check either.
Some people that I know who absolutely deserve a blue check have been formally denied.
Wow.
But on the flip side, there are people with 1,000 followers who intern at a radio station.
I don't get that. Right.
And they get a blue check. So I made a special list for them called Blue Dorsey for Blue Check.
Oh, good one. That's a good one.
I know there's a family-friendly show, but Jack Dorsey is the CEO of Twitter.
Right.
So you have to blow Jack Dorsey for a blue check.
Oh,
so that's the list I put you in. If you have, like, no reason to have a blue check, but you have one. And I
Kekistan says blue checks only given to those who visit Dorsey.
Yeah, blue. I have a list. I have a list called Blue Dorsey for Blue Check. I have a Bold Face Liars one. So obviously, every single liberal who tweets something that is complete. There are so many people in this list; it's unbelievable. The Bold Face Liars. It's supposed to be Bald Face Liars, actually. But you know, here's a little grammar lesson for you guys: Bold Face and versus Bald Face. Bold Face is what you call text that is bold.
Oh, yeah. Bold-faced text.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you're a liar, you're a bald-faced liar.
Bald-faced.
And it's hyphenated.
Okay.
So I actually did this wrong. They could troll me for that. I said bold-faced liars. So, yeah. Anyway, so the next one, brainwashed by fake news. Who retweets or likes or says anything that is clearly a regurgitation of fake news, they get the brainwashed by fake news list. Communists, that's obvious. That's self-explanatory. Cuckolds?
Cuckolds, that's a good
I
list.
I think I added McConnell to that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Here's another one for the never Trumpers during the primary season. De facto Hillary supporter. So if you were a never-Trumper during
de facto,
the general,
you are,
in fact, a Hillary supporter. There's delusional, lots of people in that list. Disgusting sexual deviant. I have a list for that.
Is Anthony Weiner on that one?
Oh, I just recently added him to that. But there's other people that when they start going down that road, they get added to that list. Disrespects U.S. veterans. That's when you get attacked with an ad hominem attack and they use the service as part of the attack.
Oh, right.
That's definitely disrespecting U.S. men. Duped by global warming.
Now that's really good.
Like that one. And this is a new one. I just made this. I just had to make this, and it's because of these people in the Democrat Party or even never Trumpers who believe that we need to get rid of Trump for whatever reason, ignoring the fact that we had a constitutional democratic election, legal, right?
Right.
So I had to add this one because I couldn't help it anymore. Enemy of the USA dash traitor.
Oh, nice.
I had to make that. You are, let me tell you something, and all you guys listening should get on board with this. We need to start calling these people out for trying to oust Trump because he wasn't the one that they wanted to be president. He not only did Donald Trump win a constitutionally sanctioned and legal election to become president, but he may have won it more like by a wider margin than we ever know. There's news out this week about massive, massive, massive voter fraud.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. There's old news about massive voter fraud. This week we found out that there were voter rolls that I think it was 7 million duplicate voter rolls where they would take millions of names from one state, copy and paste them on another state.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's news this week. So, yes, you get added to the enemy of the USA if you're saying stuff like, don't worry, it's not too much longer. Mike Pence is going to be somebody said that instead of calling Mike Pence, this was a journalist in an article, wrote, instead of calling Mike Pence VP or Vice President Mike Pence, they called him soon-to-be President Mike Pence.
Yeah, I'm done. I'm done with that.
That is treason. That's treason. Here's a good one. Not too many people can be added to this list because you have to be a real reporter. This one's called Fake News Reporter. And you will get added to that list if you are a fake news reporter. Here's another one. If somebody says something bad to me in a tweet and somebody likes that tweet or retweets it, they get added to the likes or retweets moronic posts.
Oh.
Yes. So you got to add that one. Here's a good one. I don't advocate for this anymore. I'm giving you guys good advice here. Do not get into debates in Twitter. It is completely pointless, and it hurts your brand. Don't do it.
It hurt us in the beginning.
Yeah, because I did it nonstop. I was nonstop in debates. Well, when I was done obliterating my opponent, I would add them to the losers of the debate list.
Oh, wow.
Yes, had to add that. Here's another one, Making America Great Again. I actually made that list a long time ago for people that were Trump supporters. Problem is, people don't like to be added to lists.
No,
so I don't even use that anymore. Here's one, very, very self-explanatory. This list is called Morons.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Here we go. This one is for all the pro-choicers out there. This one's called Murders Innocent Babies.
Nice.
As if there's not innocent babies. I just want to distinguish you from the ones that are murdering the guilty babies.
Guilty, because those guilty ones, convicted.
Right. Now, here's an old one for you that I had to upgrade to a new one. So here's the old one. The old one's called Paid Hillary Staff.
Oh.
That was during the primaries and general election when you were a never-Trumper. Or somebody who claimed to be a never-Trumper. You were just trolling and you were doing all this stuff. I called you paid Hillary staff. However, that kind of became obsolete once Trump won the election.
Right. Because
now Hillary's gone and she doesn't have paid Hillary staff anymore. So now I have a new list called Paid Soros Shill.
Oh, that's a good – Soros is in the news this week too.
Amazing. It must have been a conservative. Like, how does – like, you know, he's supposed to be invisible to the mainstream media.
Right, but they were exposing him as paying for helping Democrats win seats and local level elections.
Of course, and that's what he does. The next one is called Progressive Fascist because it's not just bad enough to call you progressive. In fact, some people kind of embrace that title. You're a progressive fascist if you try to shut people up or violate their civil rights or natural rights because they are not espousing your progressive point of view. That would be like an Antifa type of person. I also have a racist one, which is more of a pure troll. That's kind of like, hey, I'm sick and tired of people calling conservatives racist just to shut them up. So I'm going to create – because I knew how devastating it is for somebody to be called – now, if you get added to a list called racist,
man.
Devastating. So that was kind of a reverse troll there. And then here's a good one. You'll love this one. This is just as bad as racist. Maybe worse. It's got to be worse. This list is called Registered Sex Offender.
Oh, which Anthony Weiner will be soon. He's pleading guilty to all charges.
But can you imagine being added to the registered sex offender list?
It's so wrong.
Oh, that's a good one. And the last one is an expletive, so I'll censor myself on it. When we were in the military, and I know this isn't the same for every branch, but particularly the Marine Corps. In the Marine Corps, if you are somebody that's not holding yourself to the standards of a Marine, your fellow Marines would call you an SH blank T bird.
Right. Oh, yeah. Blank bird.
Yes.
Right.
So I create a list because, and the reason I came up with that list, because I don't like to disrespect veterans too much, try to avoid that. There was this guy claiming to be a Marine who was just a complete progressive, Hillary supporting, just troll like you wouldn't believe. And so finally, I was engaged in civil debate with him until I just realized that this guy was a crap bird, for lack of a better censored word. And so I said, I'm creating a list for this guy.
Right.
And he might be the only one on that list, but I did make that list in case I run into any other military veterans who don't love the country. They'll tell you that they love the country. They'll say, I fought for this country, blah, 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 you know, whatever. But what country are we talking about here? You know, the United States of America was built upon the framework of the Constitution. And it's pretty clear to anybody listening to this, clear to Brian, clear to everybody we, you know, in our circle, our political circle, that if you are going against the founding, which is the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, or even the philosophy of the Declaration of Independence, it's hard to say you're fighting for this country, right? So, I mean, so it could be a combination of being a crap bird and just flat out delusional. But certainly if you believe in the progressive ideology / communist ideology, you're at odds with the United States of America and the philosophy behind it and the principles and all that kind of stuff. So that's how that ended up. So that's my list. I don't know how we got on that, but I'd just love to share that. It's the first time in Smith Radio history that I actually shared with
listeners. If you're listening to us live Sunday evenings, 5 to 8 p.m. Eastern, you can go directly to the show and be a part of the message board. And that's where we came up with that idea. We have Kekistan Rose. She, I don't know how that came up, but lists came up and shared a few of their lists. And
she said she has one called Grammar Nazi.
And then
that's so funny.
One that
she's got one called Likes Own Tweets. I don't even do that. I won't do it. It's just
I'll like my own tweet if there are already likes on it.
I've had to lecture Brian on that. Like, come on. Oh no, you did it on Facebook. You were doing it on Facebook. Yeah.
Well, check That's this out. They just brought up Seth. Seth Rich is back in the movie in the movies. He's back in the media again. You know, it's painful to see this. Seth Rich, if you don't know who Seth Rich is, Seth Rich was a DNC staffer. If you pull up pictures of him on the Google, you can see him in American flag shirt, pants. Seems very patriotic, young guy. Seems like a real cool guy to hang out with, have a few beers. But he was an IT guy for the Democrat National Committee, the party, the DNC. And you don't necessarily have to subscribe to Democrat view. He just got a job and probably getting paid very well.
I think he was a progressive / you know, I think he had this pie in the sky. He was a little bit younger. I think he was 27 when he died. So he probably was involved in this stuff, early 20s to mid 20s type thing. And I don't deny that he was misguided in his ideology. I wouldn't doubt it in that, but he was more of a Bernie Sanders supporter.
Okay, I could see that.
And look at your Cassandra Fairbankses and your I'm trying to think of some of the other really prominent examples of people who were Bernie Sanders supporters. And when they saw how he was getting treated by the DNC and by Hillary Clinton, especially during the DNC convention, which I think that Mike Cernovich's rise to fame came when he exposed that real time. That was a big, big moment for him when he was doing a live cast and showing how but it was really WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks came out with all the emails that exposed that the DNC, led by Debbie Wasserman Schultz, was undermining it, not even undermining. They were making it so that Bernie Sanders' run was literally only for show. It was
show. Yeah, absolutely.
And so everybody knew about it, but Mike Cernovich actually videotaped live the DNC leaks in real time because there was two people that were shouting to the crowd for each side. There was a woman who was shouting for Bernie Sanders, and there was a young man who was shouting for Hillary Clinton. And all of the mainstream media news flocked around the guy who was arguing on behalf of Hillary, and the Bernie supporter was standing there all by her lonesome self, and the only person who turned the camera on her was Mike Cernovich.
Nice.
And it was a sight to behold.
So check this out. Somebody put up a meme this week that I caught, and it struck me as funny, and why I didn't think about this is kind of, I don't know. It's something that we would definitely come up with and think about, but I'm giving credit, I didn't do this. It was a meme of Seth Rich, and in the words were, notice how no emails that WikiLeaks exposed are dated after Seth Rich's death.
Okay.
All the emails that WikiLeaks leaked out,
mm-hmm.
they all end, and none of them cross over the day of his death.
That is fascinating. I never really thought about that because it would prove that it wasn't Seth Rich if they had any emails. Seriously.
Yes, absolutely.
Now in defense of the opposition,
it's only speculation. I mean,
it's circumstantial.
Yeah, it's all
circumstantial evidence, but very strong evidence.
And this is going to blow your mind. This just tweeted out to me by KGB Chris. Things can be doctored, you know, but apparently they've got a hold of a Metropolitan Police report. The police report, there are numbers on this police report, the event number, the time, the stamp, the date. So we could go back, and I apologize, I don't have enough time to actually go back into doing this, but I did retweet it. So go on to Twitter and you can see it. It's a police report of Seth Rich, and it shows, it details that the police officers were all wearing body cameras and audio.
Okay.
Video. Down at the bottom, in square red, what does that say, Mr. What Carey?
Was conscious and breathing with apparent gunshot wounds, a hospital. So he's conscious and breathing.
What'd he say? Where's the body cam? What did he talk about? I mean, it's interesting. Why are we all of a sudden now just getting this information that there was body cam on this guy?
If I was a cop, I'd be like, who did this? Who did this? Because, I mean, he may go unconscious
any moment
and die anytime.
Right.
Like, you know, call me callous, but it may seem callous. But if I see somebody shot up and it doesn't look good, but they're still conscious, I would go out of my way as a cop to make sure, just because of my sense of justice, that I got the right information out of him before he passed to get the damn killer.
Right. Right. You got to give me something, man. Give me something.
I'd be shaking him. Come on, who was it? You know, I'd be going crazy, like, because it's just my sense of justice. Like, I got to get this guy who did this to you type of thing, you know? And I would certainly hope that if I were in Seth's position, and I've actually thought of this a lot, where if I'm like dying, but I'm still conscious, to make sure that somehow whoever's there to either listen to me or communicate with me, that I would make sure that the last things I said was the key evidence to convict whoever did this to me. Just out of sense of justice. It's just my thing.
No, I agree 100%.
You know? So, and I'm sure Seth, you know, I don't know. Well, here's the thing. Seth certainly wouldn't know who it was.
He could have given more detail of who the guys were. Were they hooded? Were they not hooded? And I mean hoodie. I mean, yeah. not hood, but anyways, they could have described what they were wearing. Maybe skin color. I mean, anything.
Yeah. So the cops. Wow, I didn't know that. You just broke news to me.
Yeah, that
cop showed up and he's conscious and breathing.
That was KGB Chris, man.
How accurate do we know that that's true?
It's coming out of Russia, so it's got to be true.
Oh God. Clearly. Oh my goodness.
So the bombshells this week. This week we're getting into it. This is from twitchy.com. If you don't follow, or if you have never heard of the website Twitchy, TWICHY.com, I would suggest frequenting it, and definitely go on Twitter and follow @Twitchy. Incredible. As soon as I her name escapes me. As soon as I get it, I'll pull it back out. But Four Bombshell Friday, that's what she called this Friday, Four Bombshell. New York Times reports that President Trump called former FBI director a nut job, which he is. Then came the Washington Post with a report that a current White House official is a significant person of interest in the FBI-Russia investigation. Then McClatchy, with their anonymous sources, saying FBI is now investigating possible White House cover-up. CNN reported that the White House is beginning to research impeachment procedures, just in case. What? Wow. What do we do with all this? So we're getting into this. You've put together kind of a timeline, Carrie.
Yeah, we're going back to the actual, the whole secrets revealed to Russian ambassador and foreign minister story, which was early in the week. It's a shame. We should have just went live, said to hell with it, and just made a show in the middle of the week. So it seems, because of all the news that comes out all week, that it kind of feels stale. But believe it or not, this news broke since our last show last Sunday. But so what really happened was Trump had a meeting with the Russian ambassador and the Russian foreign minister behind closed doors at the White House. And the only people – there was like three people in that meeting.
Three of Americans, and then you had the Russians.
Right. And before the meeting was even over, breaking news, Trump's in there just singing like a canary, all just dumping all the secrets. Here is my question. My first thought was, is this is absolutely fake news, because how would they know? Whole bunch of people. Conservative Treehouse instantly came out with a response to the Washington Post article breaking the news that this was secrets revealed to the Russians in this closed-door meeting, that they have to be lying, that this has to be fake news. Whoa, hey. What are you doing? Just tap it. Hit it like a drum. There you go. Like a bongo. We're so professional here. Anyway, so the Washington Post article comes out, and Conservative Treehouse is like the last refuge for those of you are like, wait a minute, this has to be fake news because nobody was even in there. Okay?
Right.
And so that was the – so Washington Post article comes out. Let me back up to the Washington Post article really quick. So highly, highly classified information was revealed to the Russian foreign minister and ambassador by Trump, and they basically – let's see what they write. President Trump revealed highly classified information to the foreign minister, Russian foreign minister and ambassador in the White House meeting last week, according to current and former U.S. officials who said Trump's disclosures jeopardize a critical source of intelligence on the Islamic State. The information the president relayed had been provided by a U.S. partner through an intelligence sharing arrangement considered so sensitive that details have been withheld from the allies and tightly restricted even within the U.S. government, officials said. The partner had not given the United States permission to share the material with Russia. An official said Trump's decision to do so endangers cooperation from an ally that has access to the inner workings of the Islamic State. Here's my question. Let's just think this through here real quick. When Trump told Russia this information, or let's assume he did, which we know now he did. We're a week into this. But at the time that this was revealed, everybody just assumed this has to be fake news.
Absolutely. I mean, I was jumping out of my skin screaming fake news.
Because we could deduce that nobody in that meeting, which was very, very limited, very, very closed, no press was allowed in, nothing, that nobody would have leaked that information. That being said, why would the Russians reveal that to anybody? It was information to help them out with regards to a terrorist threat from ISIS that could affect anybody, any country, any amount of innocent people in Europe. And what that information was is that the ISIS is attempting to build a bomb out of a laptop with which they could get through security, because you can get through security with a laptop. You just check it. You say, this is my laptop. You throw it in, it goes through. But if you know, it's a pretty – laptop's big enough that you could put a pretty devastating bomb in that thing and then take it on the plane with you. So that was the big new threat. It's kind of like the underwear bomber. Well, you had the shoe bomber. You know, we used to walk through security without having to take our shoes off. Then the ISIS decided, well, we're going to have a bomb in a shoe.
Right, and then when they did the underwear bomb, boy, man, I really got it the next time I took an air flight.
Yeah, there's some people that did get
take it off.
Yeah. Well, you've seen the videos of the people putting their hands down the pants of people, children and stuff.
I posted up a video. Somebody sent me a video, and I posted it up of the daughter being accosted. I mean, like an 8-year-old daughter being accosted at the airport.
People were triggered by that. I still get notifications that people are commenting on that. Is it mine again? Man, we got a major problem with this. Wow.
There we go.
All right. Sorry about that. We need to go clear and shock all the equipment. So the underwear bomber came about because the shoe bomber failed. And the shoe bomber came about because it was like the only way to get a bomb through was in the sole of a shoe. So now they're like, oh, we're going straight to laptops because they're letting laptops through. We'll just put a bomb in a laptop. So now this was a secret that would have been revealed by some spy that's within ISIS who revealed it to our intelligence. And then it was going to be that Trump was going to deny any laptops through a flight that's bound from Europe to America.
Right.
And so then he told the Russian ambassador that you know, well, we find out later. But here's the thing. Why would Russia tell that to anybody that would put that spy in the Middle East at risk?
They wouldn't.
Right. So who's putting the spy at risk?
Fake news?
Yes! The Washington Post jeopardized this spy by coming out with this hit piece against Trump, which, by the way, is completely bogus because if you read down towards the end of the article, all the way down. Let's see how deep into this do you have to go? Let's see. Blah, 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 blah. How deep? I'm all the way at the bottom here. And oh my gosh, how far down do I have to go? It's pretty much at the bottom where it says, oh my gosh, we're like way deep into this. Okay, somewhere in this article, it basically says the truth, which is that the law allows broad latitude for the president of the United States to declassify anything that's classified. He's the only one in the U.S. As a U.S. citizen who's allowed to declassify literally anything. What does that mean? That means there is no thing that he is required to keep secret. It's up to him.
Right. If he deems something necessary to let, whether it be Israel or Russia or whoever he's talking with, to let them know, I mean, the buck stops with him. There is no secrets that are higher than him.
Right. And not only that, but there's no formal process that he has to go through in order to be allowed to say or reveal something that's secret. As soon as he says it, it's uncovered. It's no longer classified. The minute he says it publicly. Now, here's the crazy thing. I assume that he could say this to somebody, which would be legal, but still it would still be contained. And a good example of that would be telling the Russian ambassador. He could say, hey, can you relay this to Putin or the Kremlin or whatever? Keep it under hush because it's sensitive information. But We want to keep everybody safe in the whole entire world. They're trying to make bombs out of laptops, but keep that secret because if it gets out,
then they'll change their tactic.
No, it could jeopardize the spy that figured this out, right?
Right.
So the Washington Post finds this out and spews it to the whole world. And now that spy's life is in jeopardy because of the Washington Post. And they're trying to sit there and make it sound like it was Trump's fault. No, It's you leakers. You leakers are traitors. You put American lives and the American allies' lives in danger because all you care about is your progressive communist ideology and the power of those who are pushing communism on the world, starting with America. You're trying to turn America into a communist nation, and you're trying to undermine anybody who's trying to undermine the communist progressive ideology. And you'll do it at the expense of anything, including treason.
Breitbart, flashback.
Yeah.
Obama administration accused of repeatedly leaking Israeli military secrets. No special prosecutor, no investigate, no looky look into, no talk about the mainstream media, nothing. Nothing. Yeah. Silence. Crickets.
Let's rewind back to the Cuban Missile Crisis. You should go and watch the movie 13 Days, which we referenced several times in this. It's a very good way. You could also watch documentaries on the Cuban Missile Crisis, but the movie 13 Days does a really good job of illustrating that there were reporters who would find out leaked information that was extremely sensitive. It was going to put lives in danger if revealed or revealed at the wrong time. And guess what those reporters did? Because they were patriots.
They shut the beep up.
Not necessarily. They went to the president or members of his inner circle, JFK in his inner circle, and said, we know this to be fact, and we're going to print it tomorrow morning. And it caused them, administration, JFK's administration, to say, if you print that before the president has enough time to figure out how we're going to respond to this information, you're going to put lives in danger. You're going to put American lives at risk. And guess what they did? This is the New York Times, I believe, if I remember correctly. They said, you know, my journalists are going to have my head, but I'll give you 48 hours. I think they bought JFK time by holding back this information. They wouldn't print it yet. They would give them time. And so that's what they did. It was like this negotiation of, look, I got this information. It needs to be printed. But instead, the Washington Post is like, oh, you mean this will put your presidency in jeopardy?
Yeah.
All right, man, let's do it. Putting allies at risk. What do you think it's doing to America? They don't even look at the Bush.
It's ripping America.
Bush, the Trump administration, right. They don't even look at it as part of America anymore. They look at the Trump administration as part of this enemy entity that they need to defeat, right? Even though it was a constitutionally democratic process that got Trump elected, right? And they're looking at it as an enemy entity that they need to defeat in order to progress with their nation. Their ideas,
their ideologies.
Yeah, which is like your Bill Clinton's, your Hillary Clinton's, your Obama's.
What blows my mind, though, is that if it goes full social and then ends up into a communist dictatorship-type situation, the news media is pretty much just going to be government media. I mean, I don't see how they win. That the media in general does not win if this winds up full commie state.
I see what you're saying.
CNN got kicked out of Venezuela for fake news.
CNN did?
Yeah, Venezuela kicked CNN out.
Oh, they screwed up on that one.
Well,
They're both communists. It's the Communist News Network.
Right. I'm just saying, man.
Yeah, I think they made a mistake there because I think CNN would prop up a communist dictatorship.
Yeah, you would think. But so, they were exposing.
So what they're doing here what they're doing here is put yourself in the allies' shoes, like England or something like that. How could you come to America and have what you believe to be a private conversation behind closed doors with the president of the United States at this point? It cannot be done.
Yeah, and that's their job in their mind to by hook or by crook, whatever it takes, we will defeat Trump. But it's so short-sighted that defeating Trump literally is defeating the entire democracy, our process, the way we elect the fish. I mean, it's just complete what?
Oh, no, I was going to go back to the timeline. Yeah, I'm sorry about that. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Back to the timeline.
So at the time the Washington Post article came out, we were just like, oh, gosh, here we go. They have no their reputation is very, very strong. It's a strong reputation of completely made-up fake news. They have a long history of doing this, particularly when it comes to Russia. Okay? So we all were like, even the conservative treehouse was like, this is fake news. So the next morning – and by the way – CBS came out with supporting articles to support the Washington Post article. A whole bunch, and they were the first ones. A whole bunch of other mainstream media outlets came and wrote articles in support of the Washington Post article. So we were all like, wow, this is an all hands on deck fake news narrative. The next morning I wake up and President Trump tweets out, as president, I want to share with Russia at an openly scheduled White House meeting, which I have the absolute right to do, facts pertaining to terrorism and airline flight safety. Humanitarian reasons, plus I want Russia to greatly step up their effort or their fight against ISIS and terrorism. He tweets that out, and instantly I'm like, oh, you're telling me the Washington Post article was real? Was true? So yeah, these two tweets that Donald Trump posted out the very next morning not only supported the Washington Post fake news article, but also undermined a McMaster's.
McMaster's, what yeah. He said the night before.
So McMaster's comes out. Let's see. He walks out.
And he has to come back out after Trump's tweet.
Hey, good evening, everybody. I just have a brief statement for the record. There's nothing that the president takes more seriously than the security of the American people. The story that came out tonight, as reported, is false. The president and the foreign minister reviewed a range of common threats to our two countries, including threats to civil aviation. At no time, were intelligence sources or methods discussed. And the president did not disclose any military operations that were not already publicly known. Two other senior officials who were present, including the Secretary of State, remember the meeting the same way and have said so. Their on-the-record accounts should outweigh those of anonymous sources. And I was in the room. It didn't happen. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
No, man. What about Trump? What about Russia?
He's screaming at him as he's walking
Russia?
Away.
What about Russia? Russia!
Yeah, so that happened that evening, that afternoon, before... That was the same day that the Washington Post article came out. So when Donald Trump tweeted the next morning, it appeared to undermine that particular press conference. And so really what ended up happening was that I'm trying to catch up here. McMaster's came out with a second press conference pointing out that there was no conflict between what McMaster said and what Trump tweeted because, what he said stands, which is that no classified information was given up because it becomes unclassified but he did point out the next morning, McMaster's did, the next day and in the next press conference, that the media is jeopardizing our national security by posting these leaks, by coming out with these leaks. It's just terrible, absolutely terrible. So
let's see. I've got
and also there were written denials by everybody in the room that any kind of classified information was done or given away.
Well, and even if – you know what? It may have been classified in a sense that Trump's talking to Russia about something that the citizenry, the average Joe, doesn't need to know or shouldn't know about.
Right.
So even if it is classified, that's – so be it.
Well, as long as it's coming from Donald Trump as our – or any – our president, period, it's – unclassified, or at least as unclassified as he wants to make it. That's the thing. If he comes out and tells the New York Times something that was top secret, it's unclassified. But he said it in a closed meeting with Russian officials who presumably were not going to go and tell the world about it. So in a way, it even though he said it to a foreign entity, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be public, right?
Right.
It was the leakers who jeopardized. These people need to go to prison for a long time.
When you've got the – you mentioned New York Times. You've got the New York Times. It describes its source as a document summarizing the meeting that was circulated. But it doesn't say by whom. The Times does not have the document. They don't even have it in their hand. An American official simply read quotes to the Times. I mean, these are – I mean, I know you folks that are listening right now, I know you're going to town on the message board right now, and you agree and you understand, yes, all these people that they're quoting in these articles, they're anonymous. And Kekistan writes, CNN would like to announce their newest staff writer, Mr. Anonymous Source.
Well, I got the second press conference that McMaster's – this was after the tweet, so this is his follow-up.
Good morning, everybody. Hey, last week we discussed the president's upcoming trip. I promised I'd come back and go through the schedule in more detail. I'm happy to do that today. And Sean tells me there's another topic you might want to talk about as well. So I'm happy to answer any questions about that after we go through the schedule.
Oh, he's going through the schedule.
But first of all, just Secretary Tillerson will accompany the president.
Let me fast forward through this.
And operating this center, our Muslim friends, including the prime minister and Mr.
Netanyahu. He talks
Netanyahu
quite a bit.
For a private dinner.
Yeah.
He'll also meet.
Gosh.
Stakeout area yesterday, and coming out to the stakeout area, he said that the Washington Post story, which came out late yesterday afternoon, was false. Do you stick by that assertion? Do you think that every element of that story is false? And do you have anything to correct in terms of what you said at the podium yesterday afternoon?
No, I stand by my statement that I made yesterday.
Here we go.
What I'm saying is really the premise of that article is false, that in any way the president had a conversation that was inappropriate or that resulted in any kind of lapse in national security. And so I think the real issue, and I think what I'd like to see really debated more, is that our national security has been put at risk by those violating confidentiality and those releasing information to the press that could be used, connected with other information available to make American citizens and others more vulnerable.
Bam! Thank you.
I mean, that's just it.
Oh, my gosh.
And then we were talking before we went on the show, we were talking about the Harvard study that reveals that the anti-Trump media bias, some outlets are 98% hostile towards Trump. This has got to end. When we talk about draining the swamp, these are the swamp nuggets.
He needs to stop calling on these people. I may be wrong about this, but I think the guy that asked that question looked a heck of a lot like John Decker, who I thought was banned for assault from the White House after he assaulted Lucian Wintritt.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So here's Harvard media study finds Trump derangement syndrome is real. This is from Sundance, who's a prolific writer on conservative Treehouse. A deep and well-researched Harvard study finds that media coverage of President Trump is jaw-droppingly negative. So here it is. The new news outlets, CNN, 93% negative, 7% positive. NBC is 93% as well. CBS is only 91% negative.
Oh, that's not bad.
New York Times is 87% negative. Washington Post, shocking.
Washington Compost?
Only 83% negative. I find that unbelievable. Wall Street Journal, which, by the way, did you know that the Wall Street Journal during the Bush years was pretty much a conservative paper?
Yeah. I always thought the Wall Street Journal, I was had respect for it and no problems.
During Obama, people were accusing it of being a conservative paper. We get to Trump, and even during the primaries and the general election, very, very liberal suddenly, and we were like, what is going on here? They have 70% negative on Trump, which is pretty unbelievable. Fox News, the only one that's even close, they're only 52% negative, which, you know, I was riveted to Fox back in the early 2000s, all the way up through till I cut the cable.
Right.
And I will tell you that even though Fox had a lot of very truthful conservative news, they always – when they said fair and balanced, they weren't kidding. Like they had – they Juan Williams, Geraldo Rivera, they had Alan Colmes, all these people.
No more Bob Beckel.
He was on. I know he got fired. But
for saying racist things.
Racist.
Shocking. Bob Beckel is a racist. He said all kinds of crazy stuff.
Well, he's a white male. He has to be racist,
shocked,
right?
And a Democrat at that. Old school Democrat. Old dog, dog Democrat.
Did he come onto the set in the white hood? Is that how it happened?
Yeah, for the most part.
Wow, unbelievable. Anyway, so yeah, so fake news, Fox News. They're 52% negative, 48% positive. Some people, there's this false belief, and this is just in the past couple of years, that Fox News is just completely 100% conservative all day, and they just bash liberals, bash Democrats. It's never been that way. It's always been more.
Explain this to me then. I mean, if they're saying that Fox News is all conservative, then what is this?
You call us fake news and put us down like children and
you was that loud
fake
enough?
News and put us down like children.
Because you are, if you're
a child.
You know, I'm teaching my young children, 8 and 9, and the boy, 3, you know, working with them all. And I'm teaching them that if you got to tell somebody you are something or you are not something, it's because you are that thing. Daddy, I'm not a liar. Well, why are you telling me that? Oh, because I'm not a liar. Well, then what are you worried about? You don't need to tell me you're not a liar. Just don't lie, and I'll know you're not.
But I'm not a racist.
Well, just don't be one, and I'll know you're not.
Not if you're a Democrat. Right. I mean, for real.
So these any reporter that screams, I'm not fake news.
Yeah, that's... You are.
You are. Yeah.
Well, he is. There's other people that were on. I mean, Sean Hannity's is still on Fox News.
As far as we know.
Oh, yeah. That could be ending soon.
Right, right.
They went straight for the jugular right after Sean or Bill O'Reilly was busted for the.
And just a little blip before I forget, Rodger Ailes, God bless him. God rest his soul. 77. I think it's 77 died.
I didn't know what to think about him until I heard what pretty much amounts to a eulogy by Rush Limbaugh. He's got an enormous amount of respect for him. He was a personal friend of his and called the people who were celebrating his death pissants.
Yeah.
And he used that word too.
Very nice.
And the reason he called him that was because he pointed out that the people that were celebrating his death and had been completely, you know, trying to destroy him, could only dream of accomplishing in life what Rodger Ailes had accomplished in his life because they're losers. And they'll never – it's not that Rodger Ailes did so much, which he did. He absolutely did a lot. But anybody could do a lot in this world, and they won't. His detractors won't.
Which would literally change an industry.
Yeah, I mean, he changed the world. In fact, Rush Limbaugh pointed out that him and Rodger Ailes were, when they met and they got together and they got to know each other, he pointed out that he realized that they were at the crossroads of history together, and that, you know, there was this, they were there. They were at that place, at that moment where history was going to be made, and they had the front row seat of it. They were right there in the cockpit of the history making, you know.
Well, even Sean Hannity said that Rodger Ailes, if it wasn't for him, he doesn't believe that he would have had the career that he has, all the support, all the leadership, the mentorship, that just being there for him and helping to come up the ranks, just amazing. So God rest his soul, Rodger Ailes.
I can only
Fox News, FAUX.
I can only
I don't know.
I can only judge him based on what people that really knew him were saying about him, and they were saying a lot of good things. Glenn Beck said, I believe his comments about him were very neutral. I wouldn't say that he was blasting on him, but he wasn't overly positive about him. I think it was back and forth between the bad and the good. But I don't think he knew him as well. He came to Fox News later. A lot of people don't realize that Glenn Beck was with CNN for a long time. Then he got picked up by Fox News, and he said, I feel like I'm at home. What do you got going on over there? What was that?
Smith Radio.
Oh, we got a call. Oh, my goodness. So anyway, so that's what was happening with Rodger Ailes. Rest in peace. And, you know, do we talk about the – who you got?
I believe that we – and this was from the red phone. That's why it went off when it did.
Oh, wow.
Apparently, we've got Obama on the line. I know that he found out a lot of news from us because he learned about it in the news.
Oh, boy.
So can you hear us? Are you on?
Oh, well, yes. Thank you very much for having me on today. Thank you, gentlemen.
Well, Mr. Obama, I heard you say here in the news recently, and this is the thing that gets me fired up about you. Why are you still throwing this racist thing around? This week, you said the N-word, NPR. Yeah.
Did
he? Yes.
I didn't know about that.
He said, I was not like I walked down the street. Well, you tell me what you said.
Well, I mean, of course I said it. I mean, I'm not running for office again. What are you going to do?
Is this a word that you use in casual conversation, or are you trying to make a point?
His point was that you can't use it in casual conversation anymore.
Okay.
Oh, no, I hang out with my niggas all the time.
Oh, boy.
Man.
So what are you living in D.C. now, or are you still vacationing?
A little bit of that, a little bit of this. You know, I come back here to make sure the resistance is going well, see if they need any money, anything like that.
Oh, wow. So are you funneling it? It's obviously not coming from your own pocket, because that's probably not your style. You just kind of, you become like this broker. Are you a broker for funding terrorism in America at this point with the Antifa?
Oh, absolutely. I just give my buddy Soros, and he just writes us a check. You know, we just send him out there, tell him, you know, go blow shit up.
Mr. President, keep the S words down for me, please. I appreciate it.
Wow.
I do apologize. You know, I'm just sitting here stoned, and, you know, things just flip out.
Are you back with the Choom Gang?
Oh, absolutely. Them guys are great.
I guess they were part of the cabinet at some point, and now they're now. Oh, you probably half your cabinet still left in positions, right? The deep state, they become.
Well, don't go telling everybody, guys. I mean, where do you think we're going to get all these leaks from?
Apparently, they don't care because they're still there. Because if they cared, they would start firing people.
they'll never find them all.
That's true.
We've got a message board when we go live on Sunday evenings like this, Mr. O. And one of our loyal listeners wanted to ask you a question. Mary Lou wants to know if you're still leading the silent coup.
Oh, yeah.
Well, leading is a strong term. I would say that I'm more so a third-tier manager that isn't really very good at his job.
Oh, that's great. Third-tier manager. Wow, you'd think somebody who was the chief community organizer would be a little bit more higher up on the hierarchy there of the deep state. Interesting.
But you're qualified. You're qualified at third tier.
You wouldn't think that? You wouldn't think that, but look at the community I organize.
You mean the one in Chicago?
If that's what you want to call it nowadays. I just kind of refer to it as Mosul Part 2.
Oh, wow. Nice. So you are trying to – what do you think of the refugee thing going on here? Are we going to – is the deep state going to win that battle of getting the refugees to come in here in order to become the Democrat voters of the future?
I mean, that's been the plan all along, hasn't it? You know, bring in as many illegal as possible, put them in places where, you know, they won't affect anybody that I know. You'll just have to deal with them, you know, while they destroy your economy and take all your jobs.
And vote for Democrats.
Right.
Oh, of course.
It's brilliant. The refugee thing is brilliant because when you bring in illegals, there's always that chance that the law will be enforced and then they get removed. And also it makes it difficult to get them to vote because they are, in fact, illegal. But when you bring in refugees, they're not illegal. They are here and they're here to stay. And a lot of times they're – I don't know the exact law on when and how long it takes for them to be able to vote. But there is, I think, a process to eventually get them to be able to vote even though they're just refugees. But they are here to stay and they're impossible to get rid of. So that's just a brilliant thing. And hopefully Donald Trump can head you off the pass there.
Well, DJT is on the message board tonight. I haven't seen him in a while. I'm glad to see you back, DJT. He said, how is Mr. Ayers anyway?
I mean, he's great. He's still racist as ever, but I mean, he's just preaching away.
Nice.
Spreading that good word about getting rid of all them white people.
Oh,
interesting.
Good. Wow. So, what did you think about Trump's his trip to Saudi Arabia? Apparently, at the end of his speech, he said, God bless America. And people on Twitter pointed out that you quoted the Quran.
I mean, well, of course, that is my holy book.
Oh, okay. All right. I'll take that. So are you jealous that they're giving him such a great reception, President Trump, out there in the Middle East?
I mean, really, who gives a man a steak with ketchup?
Come on, man. I do. I eat.
Really?
I have been shamed.
I thought it was trolling. When he said steak with ketchup, everybody knows that that's a big joke. That has to be fake.
Oh, I know it absolutely has to be. And trust me, I'm a professional at big jokes. I gave you one for 8 years, and y'all took it.
Oh my goodness!
This is so painful.
Oh, I know. Painfully funny. Well, you know what? I'm glad it's over. Do you plan on running for world dictator at any point?
Actually, no. My next position I'm running for will just be God.
Oh, okay. Do you think you have a? You think you might win that one, or did you take any polls on that?
At this point, right now, I'm holding steady at 68% hell and 2% heaven.
Oh, wow. Oh, my goodness.
Well, you could be God of hell.
Yeah, I guess.
You know, the underlord or whatever the title be. I mean, I don't think he does it. You just got to keep the fires going and you stoke them and you do pretty good at that. So I would think.
Keep the home fires burning?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Done that.
Well, Mr. O, I appreciate the call in. I appreciate you calling in Smith Radio. And
absolutely, boys. Appreciate everything you're doing.
Oh, thanks a lot. POTUS 44. Glad that he called in. That is great.
That was stuff. On the bat line, the red phone, you know, the old school red phone.
Yeah.
So getting back into some of the news, what do you think about, and this was brought up earlier, what do you think about this independent counsel? They're putting together an independent counsel.
At first, I thought, ha, 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 just keep the Democrats busy, whatever. But then I started hearing about what happened to Scooter Libby. And I really wasn't super familiar with that story because at the time, it just really – it was too inside baseball for me. As far as I was concerned back then, as long as Bush was not directly in the crosshairs – it didn't really matter much to me. So all you heard about was this Scooter Libby thing, who leaked what, who let the cat out of what bag, and all this kind of stuff. And I just really didn't care too much about that. This was not even that far out from 9/11. We had already invaded Iraq and all this kind of stuff. And there was the whole was there weapons mass destruction or not? Do we have sarin gas? And all I cared about was that America was going to win whatever we were trying to do. And I just recently found out that Scooter Libby got railroaded like nobody's business.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, definitely.
And it was like a process crime. It was kind of like, like you're trying to find out I don't have a good analogy at the top of my head right now. But it's like when somebody tries to find out who put a stain on the floor and you're going after your two kids about it. And it turns out the dog peed on the floor. But in the meantime, you found out that in the inquiry of trying to find out who did the stain on the floor between the kids, you find out that there was a they didn't come down soon enough when you called them or something like that. And you end up punishing them for that. Well, you only called them down to ask them about the stain because you assume they did it, and they end up right. getting punished. They would have never even been called down if you had realized that the stain was caused by the dog. You know, something stupid like that. And it's just – so something happened with Scooter Libby. Ended up being a process crime that wasn't even related to what they were even inquiring about. And so what will end up happening is with this new special counsel is that they know – don't get this twisted. Everybody except for the dumb zombies on the left, I'm talking about the sheep who consume the propaganda and that are too weak-minded to think for themselves. They are the only ones who have any belief in this Russiagate story. They're the only ones. All the leaders on the left, all the mainstream media, they all know it's a big joke. It's a big troll. Because it's the only thing they have. Because the alternative to going after this fake story is to allow Trump free reign as president. Okay? That's right. Their alternative. They're not going to take the alternative. They're going to continue with the fake news. So they all know it's fake. This is no secret amongst those people. So what they're going to do is in the process of muddying up this water, they're taking an oar and sticking it down into the creek and just muddying up the water as much as they can. And in the process of muddying up this water with this stupid fake news story, they're going to catch somebody in the Trump administration in a process crime. And that's what they're going to do to start throwing people in jail. And they're hoping, they're really, really hoping that the person that gets caught up in this is actually Donald Trump. That's what they're really hoping. So it's kind of like, you know, I'm getting really inside baseball here. In wrestling, a lot of people don't know about the sport of wrestling. I've been involved with it since 85. How many years is that? That's like 32 years or something I've been involved with wrestling. And one thing about wrestling is that it's a very defensive sport. It's hard to score points in wrestling, okay, because it's easier to learn how to defend against attacks than it is to get really good at the offense in wrestling. So you end up with these really low-scoring wrestling matches. That's just the nature of the sport. Well, one thing you can do to open somebody up to score on them is to just start going nuts and just getting crazy out there and increasing your motion and just like getting into a fight practically, right? And that'll make them open up to mistakes, and then you could score on them. And I feel like that's what they're just trying to do. They're just trying to muddy up the water. They're trying to go crazy and just get cause chaos. And same thing with poker. Poker's the same way. If you're playing against a lot of really good type players on a poker table, one thing you can do to open it up – because let me tell you, if you play their game, hardly anybody's going to win any money, and you're just going to sit there and the house is going to win all the money. That's really what happens when you're on a table with a bunch of really good players who are just all playing tight. So what you can do at that poker table is just open it up and start going crazy and doing wild bluffs and getting wild. And sure, you're going to lose money at first, but you're going to cause so much chaos at the table that everybody else is going to have no choice but to kind of open up and take some risk. And that's when you capitalize on them and get all the money. And that, I think that's what they're trying to do here. They're just trying to open it up to score points by throwing innocent people in jail because they are their adversaries. They're totally willing. They're willing. I tweeted this out this week. The same people that murdered Seth Rich are the people that are trying to undermine Donald Trump. All right, so there is no boundaries. There are no boundaries.
Yeah, there's nothing they will not do to accomplish their ends.
There's no boundaries. They're going to break any law. They're going to murder anybody. You listening out there, if you wanted to get involved in this and you really wanted to fight the good fight against them, you may get murdered. We've seen this.
Yes.
All right. That being said, I mean, they're going to do whatever to open this up, and they're willing to throw innocent people in jail. They're willing to murder innocent people in order to retain power or to prevent people from taking power from them. So this is what we're up against. And for them to question me when I say that you guys are traitors, you guys are my enemy. I am an American patriot. And by you behaving the way that you are right now, you are my sworn enemy of America. And then question me about that? Excuse me, you're murdering people. And it, you may not have pulled the trigger, but you support the people that murdered Seth Rich. And you know what Mike Cernovich said today? He said, why did the DNC not offer up money for the...
No, none. None.
Why did they not say $100,000, $10,000, $50,000 for information leading to the murderer of Seth Rich? Why didn't they do that?
Because the guys that actually killed Seth Rich, they only gave him like $3,000 or $4,000. So they'd be insulted.
Good point. Good point. And they may have only gave him $500.
And they would be like, oh, 10 G's for the – I know who killed him.
100 G's. Mike Cernovich said they could offer up 100 G.
Easily.
They could. No, it's the DNC.
Didn't walk about. Well, before you had mentioned Washington Post.
Yes.
And you mentioned that this is that article that they came out with that Russia probe reaches current White House official. They literally wrote an article saying that this Russian probe. I wonder what a Russian probe. They were DJT said Russian chicks are hot. Oh, and then. Never mind. You guys are getting crazy on the message board. But okay. The Russian probe reaches current White House official. People familiar with the case say.
We went over what familiar means.
Justice Department. And then they throw this out. They're the Justice Department spokeswoman. So somebody said, and then they lead into a name. Dude, look at their articles, and this is what they do. As soon as they throw out complete lie, complete makeup, they literally blend in the very next sentence with Justice Department spokeswoman Sarah Inga de Flora said. So they just said anonymous source, unnamed person, people familiar, and then follow through with Justice Department. It's somebody's name. So if you're listening to this, and this was an audio visual type thing, you know, for those sitting at home with an adult beverage, well, just relaxing.
To, if it's video, you got to just close your eyes and imagine.
Right.
Okay.
And so they just blend through it, and then they go in, Sarah Flores said, I can't confirm or deny the existence or non-existence of investigations or targets of investigations, and an FBI spokeswoman declined to comment.
Okay, and what's that supposed to mean?
This whole article is all about people familiar, unnamed sources, and then they throw in Justice Department spokesperson say, I can't confirm nor I can't confirm it. I can't deny it. The existence or non-existence, investigations or targets, I got nothing here. And then they threw in there, FBI spokesman declined to comment.
So just kind of leaving it up for you to imagine that it's always a cover-up, right?
This story was written for Keith Olbermann.
Oh, because he would say, and we all know what that means. That's what he would say. We all know. You're not fooling any of us. That's what he
said. None of us. And then they did this other article this week. The Post reported that White House Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy, Republican in California, told in a meeting of fellow House Republican leaders. He said this in a meeting, Kerry, amongst other leaders, Republicans said, I think Putin pays him.
Him?
Trump.
Pays him?
Yeah.
For what?
No, that's just what he said. He just said, I think he pays him.
Because Donald Trump is looking for somebody to pay him something. He's broke.
Well, not only that, but he doesn't take any money as a president. We reported that he donated.
Oh, that's why he's taking money from Putin.
Right. So, okay. So, according to this, and I know you heard about this week, it's fake. The guy was joking with his other friends about fake news. the Republicans were just joking about fake news. So, but according to those that were present, the remark was a joke. Yes. Anything having to do with Trump and Russia and any connection is a joke. However, the Washington Post's source was an audio recording of the conversation, which they claimed they did not have in their actual possession, reported by Breitbart News. So the Washington Post claimed they had an audio recording of this, but they didn't have it on them, and they went ahead and reported it anyways, even though the gig... This is what we're fighting! We're fighting this fake news, deep state hate from the media. I've never seen it this bad. I don't... You know, my show, our show prep for a 3-hour show is so easy. It's so much easier now because all I do is turn on the computer, type in CNN in the Google, and then story by story, Washington Post, story by story. How about the Daily Beast? You want to talk about some fake news? The Daily Beast. Here's the title of the article. Trump officials. He looks more and more like a complete moron. That is the Daily Beast, the article, the title of the article, Trump officials, quote, he looks more and more like a complete moron.
He looks like it.
From Trump officials.
Wait, Trump officials are saying he looks more like a moron?
That's what the Huffington Post or the Daily Beast is saying.
Well, they have deep state people in there. And
so you get into the article. And it's about the nut job thing, in which we all agree that Comey's a nut job. And then it's in the wake of yet another Russia-related bombshell. Trump aides despaired because they know President Trump only has himself to blame. Trump and his senior staffers were headed across the Atlantic when the news broke that President had trash-talked former FBI James Comey in a meeting with the Russian government officials. A meeting in which Trump reportedly promised the Kremlin more flexibility. Dude, they're reporting. They got it wrong. Obama told the Kremlin, I'll have more flexibility.
Right.
They're saying that Trump said, I'll have more flexibility.
That's almost word for word. Is it? I almost feel like somebody's trolling somebody here.
This is the Daily Beast. Trump reportedly promised the Kremlin more flexibility in their relationship. With crazy Comey out of the picture.
That is almost like he said that to troll the media who are leaking that.
Right. A quote, this is apparently the Daily Beast is quoting Trump. Quote, I just fired the head of the FBI. He was crazy. A real nut job. Trump told Russia's foreign minister and ambassador to the United States, according to an official written account of the meeting first reported by New York Times. Where's that transcript?
They're just, you can't assume anything more than it's just completely made up until they start giving real evidence here.
Now, remember when he said, they're saying that Trump said, I faced great pressure.
This is like the worst junior high school you could ever imagine, where everybody is just getting together, where two people would get together and say, oh my God, did you hear what happened to Johnny? Oh my God, then this happened and then this happened. And then that girl who was just informed of all that information goes to somewhere else, goes to the next class and says, to her other friend, oh my gosh, guess what I just heard? I just heard that Johnny did this and then that. It's like the worst hearsay ever. Meanwhile, Johnny was like, guess what I told what's her name? I totally lied to her to get her to go gossip around right. The whole school about this stuff. I honestly think a lot of the stuff that's coming out of Trump himself and his real inner circle, his real close friends, are giving out false information on purpose in order to troll the press and to expose leakers. Dina Powell, did you hear about her?
Dina Powell.
She was the only person that was in the discussion outside of Trump's very closest friends.
Okay, okay.
Where he's called Comey a nut job.
Right.
Instantly, it was in the news. And she was the only one that there was like four people. And the other ones were people that would never cross Trump because they're that close. And Dina Powell was there.
So what does that say? Is she still working?
They haven't heard from her in a while. She might be on administrative leave.
How does she not know she's going to get found out?
She's
stupid.
She's a 14-year-old schoolgirl, maybe 13. And she's like, oh, my God, did you hear about Johnny? Did you hear about Donnie? Donnie said Donnie called Jimmy a nut job.
Right.
And not, you know, those kids that gossip like that, it doesn't even occur to them the ramifications to their own life.
Right. No. So this article just, it gets so wacky. The New York Times, they start going off on saying that administration officials and West Wing aides who were left grounded stateside on Friday, late afternoon, couldn't do much more than dodge questions and vent inflamed frustrations at their boss.
Okay.
So this article is saying that administration officials and West Wing aides are venting their frustration about Trump.
Why would they be frustrated with him?
Quote. They quoted these peoples. Okay. We've got no names. No names.
I don't doubt it, but they need to be fired.
Quote. If Donald Trump gets impeached, he will have one person to blame, Donald Trump. One of those administration officials said.
I don't disagree with that, but he's 90,000 miles away from getting impeached.
Oh, this was funny. I'm glad I'm not on the plane so I could be here to answer your Russia questions. And a senior Trump administration official said sarcastically and then hung up on us. It says hung up.
Yeah, because they know that you're fake news. They knew that you were going to ask about Russia because you're fake. They knew that was coming. Wow.
Yeah, this is an article from the New York Times, New York Slimes. It's a hit piece. It's a fake news hit piece. Somebody came up and asked me something crazy out of the blue, and I looked at them and said, no, it's fake news. Shut them down. A couple days later, I didn't even have the time to even think about what they were talking about because it's just fake. A couple days later, come out, yeah, it was fake news. So I told my wife, I said, if you've got people coming at you, well, what about this? What about, I don't like the way he talks, the way he says things. He ought to keep his mouth shut and just stay off Twitter. Just look at him and say, it's fake news. He doesn't do anything. It's just fake. Just walk away from it. You can't come back from calling somebody fake news. Melania Trump, strong woman, solid woman,
mm-hmm.
in Saudi Arabia, no hijab.
Right, that's good.
No headscarf.
I'm really, really relieved and happy that they did that.
Trump did not bow down to the king?
Oh, absolutely not.
Obama did.
Of course.
I was being asked about that because some members of some friends of ours had made a comment. Well, Michelle Obama didn't wear the hijab. I said, yes, she did. Well, is that fake news? No. Here's what's fake news. Say Melania Trump had to wear a hijab. That would be fake news.
Yeah, she didn't.
Oh, Michelle Obama and Hillary Clinton clearly, multiple times, donned the head job.
the head job? Okay. All right.
I'm just saying.
All right. So Michelle and Bush, did Laura Bush, did they even go there?
Oh, man. I don't know. But if you've listened to this show long enough, you know my sentiments, my thoughts on Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is hell on earth. They are literally –
They throw gay people off roofs. They chop people's heads off all the time in the middle of the street.
They have religious police that walk the malls and the streets. And if you're not obeying the religious laws, they'll beat you in the street.
Yeah, and if you're not Muslim, you cannot go there unless you're there for business.
You can't visit.
No.
There is no visiting.
You cannot visit unless you're there for business.
And so I guess we're slipping into Trump's Saudi trip.
Yeah. I don't know what to think of it. Mike Cernovich, he had a cast today, a live cast on YouTube and on Facebook, if you got a chance to look at that. I wasn't sure because I didn't catch the very beginning of it, so I'm sorry if I'm mischaracterizing this. But he sounded like he was admitting he was wrong about Trump and Saudi Arabia, and that he said, I'm taking an L. He said, I'm taking an L. I was wrong. I'm taking an L. You can't be right about everything. And I don't know. I was
what was
like,
he wrong about?
That he some about the characterization, the relationship between Trump and Saudi Arabia during his presidency.
They gave him Saudi Arabia gave him a very, very, very high honor. The pic of our show is the light show that Saudi Arabia put on for Trump. I think it was Chuck Woolery. If you follow Chuck Woolery on Twitter, he's hysterical, conservative. Yeah.
He's actually personal friends with Joe Dan Gorman.
Oh, really?
Yeah, intellectual frog legs.
Okay. So he tweeted out that there were more flags from Saudi Arabia than there were at the DNC convention.
Oh, probably less of them fell down.
Ooh, right, yeah. Right.
You're supposed to burn that flag after it falls and hits the ground, right?
Supposed to. So check
this
out.
They love burning flags.
Oh, they
They're
do?
They're actually really good at it.
They do. American flags at that.
That's what I'm talking
about.
Yeah.
So I've got two sound bites of Trump's speech. Trump gave a speech today. I'm telling you right now, I scoured the internet and the left is flipping out. We have, when I say we, conservative, Trump, has officially gotten mainstream media to repeat the words Islamic terrorism.
Okay. All right.
But his speech went quite long. I mean, when I say long, it was a decent speech. It went for a little while. The majority of his speech was the two sound bites I'm going to play you. Literally, his speech was this.
I am proud to announce that the nations here today will be signing an agreement to prevent the financing of terrorism called the Terrorist Financing Targeting Center, co-chaired by the United States and Saudi Arabia, and joined by every member of the Gulf Cooperation Council. It is another historic step in a day that will be long remembered. I also applaud the Gulf Cooperation Council for blocking funders from using their countries as a financial base for terror and for designating Hezbollah as a terrorist organization, which they certainly are, last year. Saudi Arabia also joined us this week in placing sanctions on one of the most senior leaders of Hezbollah. Of course, there is still much work to be done. That means honestly confronting the crisis of Islamic extremism and the Islamists and Islamic terror of all kinds. We must stop what they're doing to inspire, because they do nothing to inspire but kill.
Right.
And we are having a very profound effect if you look at what's happened recently. And it means standing together against the murder of innocent Muslims, the oppression of women, the persecution of Jews, and the slaughter of Christians. Religious leaders must make this absolutely clear. Barbarism will deliver you no glory. Piety to evil will bring you no dignity. If you choose the path of terror, your life will be empty, your life will be brief, and your soul will be fully condemned.
Do they believe that, though? Do they believe that? That's the thing. Do Muslims believe that if you die in a terrorist attack, that your soul will be eternally condemned? That's a big question. Donald Trump could say that all day. He could try to get the religious leaders in these Middle Eastern countries to try to espouse that, but I mean, how? I mean, well, is it going to work?
The comments that he made in talking about terrorism and the Islamic terror groups that are killing people. I know we talk about it in America. We talk about it here about Islam killing Christians, Islam killing Jews, Islam killing people who don't believe in Islam. And I've said it before, but I don't really harp on it. I don't really go off on it again and again. But I'm going to say it again because Trump reminded me that when you have a great idea or when you espouse something that is correct, you've got to say it again and again for the folks to hear it.
Yeah, okay.
If you listen to Rush, Hannity, all those guys, they say same things over
We've
and over
again. We've done that where we have a universal thought that will live on long past us and probably has been uttered by people long before us. We'll repeat that if it gets brought up in the news and we have to repeat it, we're going to do it.
The group of individuals that are dying more than anybody else, tenfold. I mean,
I'm dying to know.
Right. By the hands of, if you want to call them extreme Islam, by the hands of the Islamists that are following the Quran, they kill more Muslims claiming to be Muslim than any other sect, religion, person, individual. More so Muslims are killed, and that's how the religion stays at billions of followers. Because if they're not killing people, they don't have a stronghold. That's how they keep a stronghold on everybody. And you will always, you said, oh, no, I'm Muslim. Don't kill me. Just don't kill me. I'm Muslim. I go to the house and I'm falling on the ground and the bells are ringing and I make the trek. They lie about it. They get into Islam so as not to be killed. So this thing has to stop. It has to stop. I don't know how on earth Trump is going to get Saudi Arabia to be cool to their people.
I'd be shocked. I'd love to know what the leverage behind the closed doors is that would accomplish it. Because to me, I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. This may sound a little bit depressing, but whatever. Just my interpretation of his speech, it sounded like he was lecturing them.
Yeah, he did. He did a lot of that. And this
I'm not faulting Donald Trump for sounding like he was lecturing him. I think they need a damn good lecture. But the problem is we know that lectures to those kinds of, in those kinds of settings, just doesn't work.
Well, deaf ears.
Deaf ears, right.
And that's fine with me, though. It inspires Americans. It makes me happy to see that the president of the United States is being the leader that we knew he was. We know he is. All the reasons why we voted for him, continue to vote for him again and again because of these leadership values that he has. And he's going to tell it. He's taking the fight to them. And this is a minute soundbite. This is the last soundbite I have. Trump taking the fight to Islam and it's up to you. You want to keep doing Islam? You want to keep practicing it? You got to make a separation. You got to draw a line in the sand. People cutting heads off, people not cutting heads off. If you're not cutting off a head, you're cool. If you cut off heads, not cool. You got to draw a line in the sand.
Terrorism has spread all across the world. But the path to peace begins right here on this ancient soil in this sacred land. America is prepared to stand with you in pursuit of shared interests and common security. But the nations of the Middle East cannot wait for American power to crush this enemy for them. The nations of the Middle East will have to decide what kind of future they want for themselves, for their country, and frankly, for their families and for their children. It's a choice between two futures, and it is a choice America cannot make for you. A better future is only possible if your nations drive out the terrorists and drive out the extremists. Drive them out. Drive them out of your places of worship. Drive them out of your communities. Drive them out of your holy land. and drive them out of this earth.
It was my analysis of that correct? You got people cut. If you want to keep the Islam, you want to keep doing the Islam thing, you want to keep the Quran thing, so be it. I haven't read it. Because if I did read it, I probably wouldn't like it. But you got two sets of people practicing Islam. You got people cutting off heads. You got people not cutting off heads. If you don't cut off heads, you're cool. You can stay on this earth. But if you're going to cut off heads, I'm going to scream from the mountaintops, we will drive you out. He then referenced the terrorist acts that have happened here in America. He referenced the terrorist attacks in Europe and Russia, around the world. And he did subtly make the comment inferred that it's amazing that all these terrorist attacks are happening around the globe, but they're not happening in the Middle East. What is happening in the Middle East is people being threatened and heads cutting off, but nobody's talking about that. Anyways, we got, who was it? Kekistan Rose, the second breaking news, and just interrupt what we're doing real quick. Apparently, 911.com, Kim Jong-un, successful launch of a warhead, and gearing up for battle. Are you looking at that?
What was the website?
Breaking911.com. And there, May 21st, 2017, obviously in North Korea right now, it is Monday. And we're Sunday night here in America, in Cincinnati. Monday, Kim Jong-un orders deployment of missiles for combat. North Korea's unstable leader, Kim Jong-un, approved the deployment of a new intermediate-range ballistic missile for combat use.
Now, hold on a second real quick. They need to be a little bit more clear on deploying. Deploying can mean several things. Deploying a missile could mean that you put it into place. It could also mean that you launched it.
Well, this one says that North Korean officials said they have successfully launched a missile with a warhead guidance systems.
Well, they've launched so many missiles. Okay, so they have one with a guidance system.
Oh, no, but this was successful.
Okay.
This was successful. They've had a lot of failed attempts, blamed it on America, saying that they've been hacked.
But it's saying that North Korea's unstable leader approved of the deployment, of a new intermediate range ballistic missile for combat use. So he approved the deployment? That doesn't mean they deployed it yet. They're going through this process and they asked him, dear leader, we have a paper here for you to sign. If you would sign this, that shows that you approve that we can deploy this thing. And then he signs it, and now it makes news.
South Korea's largest news agency, which is, South Korea, I would believe them, reported that North Korea's leader observed the launch of the new ground-to-ground Pukonsong 2 missile, according to the Korean Central News Agency.
Okay.
Something's got to have to be done about it.
Well, here's another thing. I don't know if we actually reported this on Smith Radio before, but I've definitely talked to people on Twitter about this who are very concerned about North Korea. There is a video out there on YouTube somewhere. I'm sorry I don't have the exact details of the video right here in front of me, but I could just sum it up for you. It's a guy he's an American who is of Korean descent, and so he speaks fluent Korean. He was in South Korea interviewing South Korean natives, and it was translated on in words on the bottom of the screen. And he was asking them what they thought about the behavior of the North Korean leader and if they're worried, because apparently I would think South Korea would be the first casualty of a war that North Korea would launch, right? They'd be the first, they'd be the ones that were invaded.
Oh, absolutely.
They were all like, yeah, this happens every election cycle. Every. This isn't like, ooh, something's different now. No, they are literally bored to tears with this behavior. They're the only ones that aren't that concerned at all.
That's just like hysterical.
Oh yeah. And these are younger people that would be a little bit concerned about their own life.
Right. They're so close to crazy Kim Jong-un.
Well, they're like in their 30s, you know. It's not like they're in their 70s. Like, oh, I hope he invades because I could use a death right now. No, these are like people that, you know, they could have babies in the home that they're worried about their future. That kind of, they were just like, oh, yeah, whatever. They're not concerned at all. And if South Korean natives are not concerned about what's going on with Kim Jong-un, I'm not really that concerned. In fact, I think concern being drummed up by the media might be a way of wagging the dog. That's my opinion.
Okay.
And but I didn't mean that as a double, because they do eat dog in Korea.
Ooh.
So, yeah. Just saying, people. Wow. Don't be that concerned about Korea until there's either a ground force invasion of some sort or an actual missile that strikes a target and destroys something. Don't be concerned about Korea, because I'm just reading the tea leaves from South Korea, and they are really not concerned.
You know, every time you do something like that where it's it's an old guy and you know, man, just take me out right now. It always reminds me of this this movie clip.
Hey, Herb, how's life?
Taken forever.
Oh, it's taken forever.
Hey, Herb, how's life? That is from one of my favorite all-time movies, Kingpin.
Oh, I haven't seen it.
What?
I'm like this movie buff guy. I've seen like so many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of movies. Not seen Kingpin.
With Woody Harrelson and... Right.
Have not seen it. Is it good? Oh, it's a good movie?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I'm really dropping the ball.
Folks on the message board, let me know. What do you think of the movie King? Old school movie Kingpin?
Oh,
tell me.
Goodness.
Don't just like it because I say I like it.
Yeah,
like it because
don't patronize Brian.
Do not do that. No, so, okay, let's back to the original story before we hit the breaking news. But apparently North Korea is still playing crazy games, and China backing off of wanting to protect them. So we'll see how much longer Kim Jong-un can keep that up. Jake Tapper tweeted out this week, NSC officials hope for no diplomatic incidents on Trump trip to Middle East. Did you hear about this?
No.
Mainstream,
I never hear about anything. I'm like totally in the dark here.
Mainstream media comes out with multiple articles painting Trump, and I got some of this from listening to Rush this week. So if you listen to Rush, I heard it too. But they're painting Trump as a five-year-old child.
Oh, yeah. I actually had this conversation with you early in the week.
Yeah, we did talk about this. Five-year-old child. He needs his nappy time. He needs his recess time. He needs his downtime.
I don't usually openly laugh out loud when I'm listening to Rush. He's entertaining. He's funny at times, but a lot of times it's serious stuff he talks about. So there's not a lot of laughing. When he was discussing that article, I was definitely rolling on the floor laughing. It was hilarious talking about. But what Brian and I were talking about, my take on that article is broader. And you guys should recognize this. I've gotten good at recognizing this. And I will openly admit that I did not recognize this kind of stuff when I was a little bit less experienced in politics, in political writing and debates that you find in the message boards and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
And that is the blatant abuse by the left of a fallacy, a logical fallacy, a debate fallacy called the straw man.
Ooh, the straw man. You mean like from Wizard of Oz, straw man?
Well, basically what a straw man fallacy is it's a debate fallacy where instead of arguing the facts, you create your own facts and you obliterate them. You beat up on those facts. So what they do is, in the case of this article, they create Trump to be this really immature, extreme, childlike figure.
Right. And I got a guy at work that is a hardcore conservative. He would refer to himself as original Tea Party. I'm a libertarian Tea Party kind of guy. And he comes to me and he's like, yeah, this childishness of Trump.
I'm like, right. They're buying into the straw man.
Dude, fake news, bro. Fake news.
Right. So what they do is they're creating the straw man. And believe me, there's a whole bunch of examples of different types of straw men that are created by the liberal media. But in this particular case, the straw man that they built up is a Trump figure, a straw man shaped like Trump, except they're telling you these characteristics of Trump that are not real, that's not true, but they're telling you these fake characteristics. Well, that's the straw man. And then they talk about it as if it's the real Donald Trump, but it's not. It's the straw man. So they're talking about how he needs his nappy time, he needs plenty of rest, he's going to have jet lag, and he's going to need his steak cut up into little cubes and served with ketchup and you know, stuff like that. And it's all completely fake. It's the straw man. But that's just another example.
So CNN, some guy named Nick, I didn't get his last name.
You don't need to know.
I didn't get
Nick from CNN.
I didn't get his last name.
So? Who cares?
I made myself laugh. Because I even looked at it like, oh, I didn't get his last name. I'll go back and get it.
No.
I never went back. I'm looking at the show notes. No.
Nick from CNN.
N-I-C Nick. N-I-C.
Oh, you don't even know if it's spelled with a K or not.
Right.
Oh my goodness.
He wrote an article on Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, CNN, Nick. With his address in Riyadh, our friends will never question our okay. So he's talking about Trump and his speech that he gave, and he's kind of bashing Trump for the most part. So he quotes Trump and then comes back and talks about it. So he says, with Trump's address in Riyadh, quote, our friends will never question our support, unquote. President Trump sought to roll back perceptions that America's ambitions in the Middle East are in retreat. I did not know our ambitions in the Middle East were in retreat. Did you know that, Kerry?
I did not know that at all.
CNN just broke news. He goes on to say, by design or coincidence, Trump's remarks on Sunday mirror those made in similar settings 5 years ago by Russian Foreign Minister Sergey Lavrov. They are quoting Foreign Minister Sergey from Russia saying that 5 years ago Russia said what Trump is saying today. Russia said the same thing. Am I looking too hard into this, or did they just throw more Russia content out there?
Well, are they trying to say that Russia is so in tune? I'm sorry, Trump is so in tune with Russia that he's pretty much plagiarizing them?
He says 5 years ago, Russian Foreign Minister Sergey told Arab League in Cairo, Russia will always back its allies. Okay. Russia always backing their allies. How is that the same as Trump saying our friends will never question our support? I mean, it's similar,
but yeah. I mean, they're definitely grasping at straws.
Why would you quote Russia? There's the only one reason why you would do that, to keep this propagating.
And it's a five-year-old?
Yes.
A five-year-old remark.
Yes.
Which means they have been scouring through thousands and thousands of transcripts and translating it all.
Had to.
And saying, where can we find similarities? There's got to be some ties here. This is the most convoluted game of connect the dots I have ever seen in my life. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable.
In 2011, Lavrov, who recently was a guest at Trump's White House and had been at the center of controversies Trump just left behind in Washington, was also trying to win over the U.S. Arab allies. But the biggest danger for Trump is perhaps not the message itself, but buying into the hubris around his own trip. So they're literally saying that the biggest danger is that Trump is buying into the fact that his trip may have some impact. That's the danger. Not the Russia, not the controversies he left behind in D.C., jet setting away on his trip, getting out of town while the town is hot. It's him believing his own words.
Oh, my gosh. Another part of that article from before, we were talking about him being a child, was that he needs his he needs to get on the golf course and play. He needs plenty of downtime. They said he needed lots of downtime.
Trump sleeps 4 hours a night.
Right.
He doesn't get to bed before midnight. He's up by 4 or 5 in the morning.
He's able to survive off of only 5 hours of sleep because he gets lots of nappy naps, and he gets a lot of also a lot of play time.
Wow.
It's a play on the playground. Okay. The golf course, yeah. Okay. So anyway.
Angela Dewan, also on CNN. President Donald Trump's speech Sunday will likely be met with, wait for it, skepticism and racism and frustration in the Muslim world. According to experts in the Middle East, who said his sudden shift in tone on Islam was unconvincing. Trump gave his speech in Saudi Arabia where he ditched his hardline rhetoric from the 2016 election campaign, instead calling Islam one of the world's greatest faiths. Now, don't get me wrong, he did say that. He did say Islam was one of the world's greatest faiths.
Well, he said, no, one of the world's great faiths.
Great faiths. Oh, they put in greatest.
Well, this says great.
Oh, great. Okay, never mind. I'm reading too far ahead. Okay, so.
And that's G-R-A-T-E.
Because that's what they do. Okay, so guess who their experts are? Three experts.
Okay.
One former Jordan justice minister, a professor, the second person, professor of,
An assistant professor?
Oh, yeah, an assistant. My abbreviation was.
Yeah, you put ASS.
ASS professor.
Yeah, he's the assistant.
He's an assistant professor of inner politics in Beirut and a poli-sci professor at Iran's Tehran University. Tehran University.
Yeah.
So they dug up three people out of nowhere.
Yeah, but they have degrees.
They've got papers. Papeles,
yes.
They've got papeles. So I'm just... I'm putting this out there because this is what they said about Trump's speech. This is what they're saying about Trump. It's every minute of every day to do something to discredit, dishearten. And I know some of the folks on... might have been Mary Loop. Forgive me if I'm wrong. On the message board that made the comment, I feel like we're not... You know, the deep state is winning. I feel like they're winning. The other side's winning. No. They have the media in the palm of their hands. And the media's job is to make you feel disheartened.
Yeah, the media's doing as good a job as it can to make sure that you believe that they're winning.
Right. Just like my friend or guy at work who said who hates on Trump all the time because of the things he's listening to. He even made a comment. He said, yeah, I'm independent. I'm a libertarian. Hey, man, the other day I was listening to NPR on the radio, and I was like, whoa, dude, now I know where all your stuff comes from, because NPR, no, I only listen to them for not political stuff. I listen to them for other things. I got to shut the guy down. Okay, you got to walk away from that.
Right.
When you start to find out where people get their information from, then you know exactly who they are.
Yeah, and you could figure it out really quick, too. I mean, I had somebody on... Facebook, who I've been friends with for since we were in second grade. We went to school together.
Right.
He is a black man.
Okay.
He's like a grandfather now. He started early. So, yeah.
Is he your age?
Yeah. I think he's a grandfather now.
No.
He got started early.
Well, my brother's daughter is 23-ish.
Oh, my gosh. She's old enough to drink now?
Oh yeah. Have been for a couple of years.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, that's crazy. And he's my age, too. So.
And if she had a child at 18, 19, then my brother would be a grandfather at 40.
Right. And so he is a very, very anti-Trump person. But when he posts, it's like, where did you come up with this stuff? Like, here's the post he put up, and you tell me how you would react to this, Brian. This damn fool. I don't give a damn if we are good friends or not. And he wasn't directing this at me, but he's directing it at everybody like me who's friends with him or whatever. But he said, I don't give a damn if we're good friends or not. Why in the hell did you all vote for this effing fool? This is unprecedented. My God, answer the damn question. So I took that as,
you want me to answer it?
So what would you say to that? I mean, think about what he actually said. What would you say to that?
You're misinformed?
Well, yeah, but think about it. What was he? Was he upset about? He never said what the heck he's talking about. I'll say it again. Read it again.
Okay.
This damn fool. I don't give a damn if we're good friends or not. Why the hell did you vote for this effing fool? This is unprecedented. My God, answer the damn question. So I'm like,
what's the question? Right. Okay. So what's the question?
Well, the question was, why did you vote for this damn fool? My question was, I don't know if I answered it with a question, but I basically was like, I'm going to find my answer on here. Here it is. I said, wait, what is this in reference to? Yeah, I voted for him, and yeah, I can explain why, but why the outrage over it right now? So I have no idea. So he answered it with, why the outrage now? I've been outraged over this guy from day one. I knew this guy was not fit for the job. Every week since Trump has been in office, it's been problems. You are, as a Trump voter, happy with the job Trump has done so far? The jury's still out on Trump. You still can't continue to support this madness if you like. Or you can deny it and continue to support this madness if you like. That is your right. So I'm like, he still hasn't answered what the heck this is about.
No,
like he's just upset about nothing. He's been brainwashed by fake news. But I'm not going to – like I would say that to his face, but – I mean, I don't want to inflame the situation. He needs to kind of come to that conclusion on his own. But I responded to that, too. I said, yes, I'm happy with the way he's been able to do so far, and especially happy with the speed he's been doing it. I can't think of anything I'm supposed to be outraged about. The only outrage I see in the news is leftists upset that he's getting stuff done in fake news such as Russiagate. I don't really see what the problem is, and this is coming from someone that follows politics on an hourly basis.
Right.
I mean, sure, that was the end of it. He did not respond to that. He's probably just realizing he's barking up a wall. You know, with some substance. I mean, tell me what happened that's got you so upset.
Yeah, what is it that's making you drop F-bombs?
It's totally ambiguous. He didn't actually spell out the F word. He F-ing. He actually spelled that.
Does that make a difference?
He's not one to be like actually cussing. He would actually probably say that in real life. He would say, effing, I think. He's one of them types of guys. You know, he's got kids, he's got grandkids, he's just whatever. But he did say F-ing. But anyway. So, yeah, the bottom line is that you're being lied to nonstop by all the fake news media. We showed you earlier in the show, or told you, I read it to you, the way that they're reporting negative on all these mainstream media outlets. It's going to have an effect on you. You need to be monitoring what it is people are saying to you. You need to, before you just accept it as fact because it's coming from a news outlet, it needs to go through a pre-filter as it's entering your ear. Before it gets soaked into your memory as fact, you need to say, whoa, 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 what's being said here? And is it believable? And if it's coming from any mainstream outlet and it's about Trump, it needs to be really examined, seriously examined, And it needs to be thought of as, well, first of all, it's coming from CNN. So I know that they're trying to go negative on Trump. Is this just being biased? Are they being biased? You know, those kind of questions you need to be asking. And also, are they – is this an opinion piece or is this a fact-based journalist thing? And if they're trying to portray it as fact-based journalism, what is their – their support for their facts? Is this a unnamed source?
Somebody on Nettie on the message board said, need a scoop of ice cream and take a nap.
Maybe. Okay.
Can
somebody provide that?
It's possible. Two scoops.
One scoop
scoops.
Is not going to do
no,
it.
No, Kekistan's got it right. You make it two scoops, you got a deal. Got to be two scoops.
Yeah, do not try to pull off the one scoop. He will... Yeah, that could be ugly.
No good, no good, no good. What is going on with the Rolling Stones? Did they get into politics to be getting into politics? I mean, what aren't they music and like fashion or something?
Fashion? Fashion?
Maybe leather pants.
The only thing I've seen he was featured in moves like Jagger by Maroon 5.
Oh, no, the magazine Rolling Stones.
Oh, I think it's about Rolling Stones. Well, you said music, and I was like, I don't know. Did Mick Jagger started getting political? I don't know.
No, he hasn't, actually.
Rolling Stone has been completely political for many, many years.
It just blows my mind the garbage that they were running around with on their articles this week. I'm beside myself, and I'm only bringing this up because you guys have to know the Rolling Stones is part of the swamp too. They're part of mainstream media. They're part of the Huffington Post, the Daily Beast, the Washington Post, CNN, MSNBC, CBS.
They're definitely fake news for sure when it comes to politics, no doubt about it. Let me go ahead and get sidetracked because that just jogged my memory on something that – there's a connection here that is awesome. I think everybody needs to know this. I have been desperately trying to get an opportunity to get a message to Donald Trump that he needs to stop talking to mainstream media, the fake news media, and empowering the real news by talking to them. Now, there's other people out there like, no, just keep tweeting. We need to cut off the press conferences and we need to just have him tweet. He needs to take his message directly to the people. Let me tell you something. People want to hear Donald Trump. People will seek out whatever platform they need to go to find him and listen to him. You know, he bragged about how 60 Minutes has this huge platform of people where people go and they'll watch and they got record numbers when Trump went on 60 Minutes. It wasn't because 60 Minutes gets record numbers. It was because Trump was on there.
I'd bet you my house we would get record numbers if Trump came on.
Absolutely. He actually went on Wayne Dupree, and I'll bet you – I haven't had a chance to hear what kind of numbers he did on that particular
during the campaign. Yeah, so jealous.
It was actually during the primary, so it was real early on. And he got on there, and I'm sure they did record numbers there. Here's my point. He needs to go on these outlets that are – it doesn't have to be people that are just supportive of him, just people that are fair and real. He could get interviewed by Tim Pool. Tim Pool is a liberal who a lot of people are saying is being red-pilled. Fine.
Okay.
Mike Cernovich used to be a liberal. He's kind of jumped on the Trump train. Cassandra Fairbanks was a Bernie Sanders supporter. And became a Trump supporter because of her – she was disillusioned by the DNC.
Dude, never Trumpers hated on her.
Yeah.
Blasted and blowing her up. So not cool.
Here's my point. I'm glad we're thinking about the Rolling Stone because I would use this argument if I ever got a chance to talk to Donald Trump. I would say, listen. You know how the Rolling Stones got started?
The band or the paper?
No, the Rolling Stone, the magazine.
Okay.
Out of nowhere – like their first episode or something. They just were starting up out of nowhere. They got an exclusive with the Beatles.
Well, that helps a lot.
And people were like, I need to get this magazine to see what's up with this exclusive interview with the Beatles. And they were – it was off to the races from there. Donald Trump needs to go on these fledgling, nobody knows, real news outlets. And even like Dave Rubin. Dave Rubin's actually pretty popular. He should go on there. Dave Rubin is a liberal who has a pretty good Trump train following because he's gone. He's been red pilled. In fact, people have sent him red pills. Literally.
Really?
He said he's got this big giant one. It's like the size of a bowling ball.
Oh, that's
that somebody sent him.
That's hysterical.
Because he's been red pilled. Donald Trump could go on there. This guy's fair. He's real. He says some stuff that's totally fair. And it's real. He's not going to say something that's fake in order to satisfy an agenda. He's not going to lie to people because he just wants the facts and the truth to get out there. He could come on Smith Radio. Look, we're small, okay? We have a small audience. He could come to us and we would be totally fair with him and we wouldn't embarrass him. We wouldn't, you know, go off the rails.
We would have respect.
Yeah,
and I would respectfully ask him, sir, with all due respect, what the hell are you doing in Saudi Arabia? You
No, come on.
If you say with all due respect, you say whatever you want after that.
Yeah, I don't mean to insult you, but no. So Brian just ruined any chance we had.
Them is jokes for the masses, folks.
No, you – okay. So he, as the leader of the free world, he should reach out and go visit the leaders of other countries. I think that that's important. So, you know – I wouldn't say, what the hell are you doing in Saudi Arabia?
I would ask him. I know that he
lectured them. That's good.
Yeah, I like the way that you came at them. And honestly, the speech that he gave when in Saudi Arabia, I don't know how you could have been more. I did a great job. I don't know how he could have done it differently. So yeah.
I would say, listen, if you're going to continue to have press conferences, you need to order your press secretary, whether it's Spicer or somebody that's not a moron, to only call on people like Lucian Wintrop, Jack Prasobic. If Cassandra is in there for one day on a one-day pass, ask her if she would like to ask a question.
Right.
Even Mike Cernovich was in there with Cassandra. Ask him. Hopefully they have good questions, and if not, give them some practice. Give them a question every day. Let them follow up. Yeah. They got a follow-up question. Give them a follow-up. And do it right in the face of CNN, MSNBC, ABC, CBS, NBC. Do it right in their faces. And then after they're done asking all of their questions and you answering all their questions, say, thanks, I'm done for the day, bye-bye, and walk out of there.
What about Russia? Russia, yeah, Mr. Absolutely. Trump, Russia.
You need to call on those people. Let them ask their questions. They're going to be a little awkward at first because they've never done it before. And then after a while, they're going to get really good.
I'd be like, Mr. President, sir, with all due respect, this guy over here from CNN right here, right in front of you. I mean, he stinks. Get him out of here. Get him out of here.
That's probably not the right question to be asking, but well, like Mike Cernovich, he wanted to ask a question that would basically require Sean Spicer to bash on the mainstream media. And I'm like, no.
Ooh, yeah.
Well, it's just Sean Spicer represents the executive branch. He's there to answer questions on behalf of the executive branch. He needs to be asking questions that are pertinent to the executive branch. And I even told Lucian Wintrop last time I got a chance to hang out with him, you need to ask them what they're going to do about these terrorists that are denying people their freedom of speech.
Right.
Because back in the civil rights era, the 60s, the executive branch stepped in to make sure that little black girls, 6-year-old girls that wanted to go to an all-white school were able to get there safely.
Right.
They were escorted by marshals who were under the jurisdiction of the executive branch. They were sent there by President Johnson. So my question is, are you going to send in the marshals to protect people who are having a legal assembly that are espousing freedom of speech and getting assaulted by people who are trying to shut down a freedom of speech rally using masks over their face and giant, huge, what was that thing? A box wrench, an open-ended wrench. Did you see that? That was Richard Spencer got punched by.
Oh, right, yeah.
Well, it turns out the guy had an 18-inch long open box wrench.
In his sleeve.
In his sleeve. The thing must have weighed 10 pounds.
Dude, you could kill somebody with that.
Absolutely. And he had it in his sleeve.
I knew a guy who got hit with a hammer.
Oh, my God.
And he went into a coma. Years. Just never. I mean,
are
yeah.
Are you kidding
yeah.
me?
Yeah.
Wow. That's just,
yeah, bad news.
Not good. Yeah.
So, and this is a box, a wrench, a right. giant wrench.
So that was my question that, so if Lucian ever get at this point, it's stale. That question is stale. He can't right. ask that question now. But at the time, we had Antifa rioting at every single free speech rally. The Berkeley things were going out of control. And who is funding these people? And can we have the executive branch come in, step in, the federals? Because the local law enforcement was allowing it to happen. It was blatantly obvious. Right. They were even being interviewed, sort of. They're having cameras put in their faces. I'm talking about cops. Cops were having cameras put in their face by Real News citizen journalists, ask them why they're not over there protecting these people. And they're like, eh, it's not our job. It's like, what?
Wow.
Anyway, so that's my rant. And the point is, if the Rolling Stone could come out of nothing because they get exclusive with the Beatles, then why can't a Smith Radio or a just all these places that the, you know, Rebel Media is getting pretty big, and I know InfoWars is getting pretty big. But they're not big like mainstream media big.
Right, right.
And why can't he go and just turn a little fledgling, truth-telling citizen journalist outlet and turn them into the next Rolling Stone by granting them access to interviews with the president? You know,
right.
That's how Rolling Stone got started. Just do it.
So they do a political hack job of an article and literally Drudge put this up, and Drudge retitled it, "Why are we? What are we investigating Russia for?" That was his title, troll title. So I got into it.
Yeah,
yeah. The Rolling Stones article, the entire article, nothing more than just an absolute hack job. They got into some name talking to James Clapper and repeating what Clapper said, and some different instances where they were on CNN and MSNBC and bringing these guys up, and then saying at the end that this Russiagate may have originated in information. May have. In information gleaned by the intelligence community, who in turn may have tipped off the FBI. Maybe.
This is so stupid. We all know exactly where Russiagate came from. It started with a dossier.
I love that dossier.
From 4chan. I'm not sure. I think
Golden Shower Gate.
It's a little bit obscure how the origins of it. It sounds to me like a bunch of Bernie Sanders supporters hoping that it was going to be Bernie Sanders versus Trump in the general election.
Oh, I could see that.
Decide to come up with stuff to attack Donald Trump with. And they were literally making it out of nothing. And so they came up with this big old Trump dossier. Well, it turns out these same people who were ready to go attack Trump were disenfranchised by the DNC because the DNC leaks and all that kind of stuff. And so they decided that they weren't going to use this against Trump, but somehow it ended up being found out by never Trumpers in the Republican Party. Your McCain's, there was Egg McMuffin. Egg McMuffin was a big one. By the way, Egg McMuffin is a big CIA guy. So they started shopping it around, this fake Trump dossier, the Golden Shower Gate, if you will, to all these different news outlets, and they were all rejecting it because they all knew it was fake. That's an interesting part of this story. Why is it that the Trump dossier was totally laughed at, and all these really serious journalists, big time, high up journalists, were like, yeah, I'm not running with that. I am not putting my entire career on the line for some dossier that has no basis in fact. I don't think this is real. I'm not going with it. It's been rejected by all media outlets until the very end, when the Washington Post was ordered by somebody on November 24th to blame the loss of Hillary Clinton on Russia.
Comey even referenced the dossier, the fake dossier.
Yes. Well, the Washington Post article on the 24th didn't reference it yet, but later on, that fake narrative was supported by the fake dossier later on.
Right.
And so it started growing legs, but this is long ever. The Trump-Russia BS was not even brought up until November 24th, which was almost, what, 3 weeks? Almost 3 weeks after the election, like 2 weeks after the election is when it was brought up. And then they decided to run with it. They decided to run with it as an excuse as to why Hillary lost, but also a way to undermine the legitimacy of the presidency, which I believe, since it's fake, if it was real, it'd be something to really say about it. But since it's fake and it's a lie, and they're using this lie to undermine a legitimate, legal, constitutional president, that it's treason. It's very, very traitorous to go down this road, because you're undermining the entire United States government by pushing this narrative. So they see it had legs. There were people that wanted to believe it. The reason people wanted to believe it is because when passions are running wild, you tend to believe anything. Have you ever been to a game? Any game, you name the sport, and there's a call that the referee makes, and it actually affects the outcome of the game.
Yeah, soccer.
It could be soccer, it could be a football game, it could be basketball.
International soccer is driven by referees. If they don't like the outcome of the supposed game,
they'll keep adding minutes.
Because you play soccer and you know what I'm talking about.
They keep adding minutes until the right outcome happens.
It's a fake. Soccer is fake.
All right, well, I don't want to get too far off my analogy. Let's just say a football game. And the referee, a perfect example is when there was a joint catch in the end zone. Do you remember this one? Two players, opposing sides, both catch the ball. They both have their arms all the way around the ball.
Right.
So their arms are linked like a chain.
Right.
And the ball's in the middle. And they come crashing down in the end zone, and they're both wrestling. And they both have the ball, and they're both wrestling. The ref takes one look at it and says, yeah, that's a touchdown.
Touchdown.
Yeah. And he calls a touchdown. The guy who wins the touchdown, and by the way, this was for the whole, it was a Hail Mary. It was for the whole game. This was it. The guy who gets the touchdown, let's go, jumps up and down and cheers, and the guy who lost the game has the ball in his hand. So what does all the fans do of the losing team? They will not accept, it's in their mind, they create this narrative in their mind that that game was robbed from them. But if you look at the rule book,
the rule book is the offense.
Well, the rule book is whenever you have a joint possession, a dual possession of the ball in football, the offense gets the ball. Period. They're the ones who caught it. There is no interception. You cannot intercept the ball if the receiver on offense also has the ball. It's not like a jump ball in basketball.
Right.
The receiving team gets the ball. Well, if it's in the end zone, it's a touchdown.
Automatic.
Right. They would not accept that. They would not accept that. And why? Because it's their home team and passions ran high. They were very upset that their side lost. And this is just one example. It happens every single day in sports where the fans will believe the falsehood that a bad call went against them or a good call went against them because their passions are running high.
You know what? The underdog kind of comes into that play too.
Oh, so you're saying neutral people who are neutral will always say underdog got ripped off.
I've done it because there's two teams at play. I didn't care for either one of them.
You didn't care for either one, but you wanted the underdog.
Yeah.
The underdog always gets ripped off.
Dude, it's the American way, the underdog.
So if the underdog loses, they got ripped off. But if the underdog wins under a bad call, you're going to accept the call and say, yes, the underdog wins.
Yeah.
If you're neutral.
Yeah.
But if you're, doesn't matter what happens, if your team is the loser. They got ripped off, or if they won on a bad call, that was a good call. So you're willing to accept a complete and utter lie. And so that's where this Russiagate comes from. The sheep and the Hillary Clinton supporters, or the people that hate Trump, the never Trumpers, you're GOP people who hate Trump because they wanted Cruz, or if they're establishment, they wanted a Jeb Bush or a Kasich or whatever. They're going to believe the lie. And what happens when you believe a lie? Eventually, in your mind,
it becomes true.
Oh, it becomes the absolute truth.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And so that's what happened with this Russiagate thing. It's still not true. There's some people out there that do accept in their subconscious and in their conscious that it is true. That it is false. That it is false.
Right. But they're willing to go down that road anyways.
Because too much is at stake for them. They know it's false. The media, the liberal media, they know this is false. The politicians that are pushing this. Maxine Waters absolutely knows that this is a fake story. Absolutely.
I have not called for impeachment.
Are we going to get into that story?
We can do whatever you want.
We got a half hour left. Let's make this happen.
You impeach somebody for just being who they are, or would they have to do something wrong?
That was thrill up my leg, Chris Matthews.
We're going to talk about impeaching Trump.
Yeah, so he thinks that he's not sure. We'll let you know what he thinks.
He's got a panel there, and he's trying to Kerry threw this out at me. I'm like, Kerry, listen to what he's doing. Kerry's like, he's just trolling him, trying to get him to bite.
Yeah, he wants to make news. He wants to be able to report the exclusive that he had experts on his panel say that you don't even need to have high crimes and misdemeanors to impeach a president.
So go ahead and impeach him. And Chris Matthews would go down in history as the man who took down Trump.
Here's the weird thing, though. You're supposed to, according to the Constitution, you're supposed to have a high crime or a misdemeanor in order for Congress to go ahead through the process of impeaching the sitting president.
They impeached Clinton, but never removed him from office.
Well, yeah, and if you want to go really into the details of that,
we don't have to get too crazy about it.
And the Senate acquitted him.
Right.
Is what the whole story is on that. But he was impeached by the House. But anyway, here's the thing. Who's going to – if you got a bunch of senators and – well, let's just say the House because they're going to start it. Say you got a bunch of representatives, a bunch of congressmen who just vote yes on impeachment. And it goes through the House as an impeachment without any high crimes or misdemeanors. Who is there? What's the check and balance on saying, whoa, 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 we're not going to accept your impeachment because there's not even a high crime or misdemeanor? It would be this. I guess the Senate would have to say that. The Senate would have to come through and say, no, the House got this wrong because there's no. But what if the Senate does that? What if the Senate says, yep, looks like impeachment to me. And then boom, just like that, you're impeached, even though there's no high crime or misdemeanor. It's what it boils down to. This goes back to the old adage that we pointed out. I didn't make this up. I heard this somewhere, and it was fascinating. Fascinating philosophy. In America, at least, and probably everywhere in humanity, laws have to be voluntarily followed. There has to be a voluntary acceptance of a law.
Yeah, laws are – yeah, if you – there's no respect and there's no voluntarily – I could go down the street and drive on the wrong side of the road.
You could.
I could. I could not pay my taxes.
That's a little harder.
Wesley Snipes.
Here's the thing. Wesley Snipes did get charged. But here's the point. Somebody brought this up that I thought was really interesting. The law enforcement in this entire country or in your state or in your county, or in your city, or just locally in your little town, they are vastly, vastly outnumbered by citizens. They represent a teeny, teeny, tiny minority of citizens. What does that mean? That means that if a majority of citizens decide to break a law, they don't have enough personnel to do anything about it. That means that laws are being obeyed voluntarily. They can't just arrest. If everybody decided to hell with this law. I'm not going to abide by it. They don't have enough jail space. They don't have enough cops. They don't have enough judges or enough time in the day to drag people through court to prosecute everybody.
Right.
They're just, it wouldn't happen. So laws are adhered to voluntarily. Same thing, similarly, in the House and Senate and Congress in general. They don't, I mean, sure, it says high crimes and misdemeanors, but what if they all just jointly decide, yeah, I don't care if it says that.
Yeah.
I'm going to vote to impeach because I just feel like it.
And we'll let Obama do whatever the hell he wants for 8 solid years.
Yeah.
And nobody, yeah, not a single sitting politician on any side anywhere.
Oh, Boehner, impeachment's off the table.
Yeah, he took it off the tape, not even on the table.
Yep. Good old Representative Boehner, Congressman Boehner.
How about Boehner there, Sam Keels? You got anything on Boehner?
Oh, I'm sure he does.
He's blasting on Bush right now. So this was Chris Matthews.
You impeach somebody for just being who they are, or would they have to do something wrong?
If they would have said, no, you can impeach them for who they are, then that would give...
Chris Matthews would have been all over that.
He would have been pushing Democrats in the House and the Senate to start bringing up charges. And then you've got John McCain, Mitch McConnell, Lindsey Graham, all saying that, this is bigger than Watergate.
What is?
Did you hear that?
Oh, they've been screaming Nixon, Nixon, Nixon all month long.
Matt Drudge trolled me with a title of the sorts of Republicans fight over who called for impeachment first. So Maxine Waters, a Democrat, lunatic, just as crazy as Nancy Pelosi and the rest of the gang, is on the mainstream media, and they can't take the fact that she's backing away from him. Well, just listen. Here's Maxine Waters and MSNBC not allowing her to walk away from impeachment.
I have not called for impeachment.
You said I'm going to fight every day until he's impeached. That's what you tweeted.
Yeah, but here's what I...
So he got violent in that interview. He's mad.
Was he a conservative? I don't even know who that was.
No, it was a lib, MSNBC.
He was calling her out, though.
He said, but whoa.
Oh, he was mad that she wouldn't say it again.
Right.
He was okay.
But here's your tweet. So, okay, here we go from the top.
I have not called for impeachment.
You said I'm going to fight every day until he's impeached. That's what you tweeted.
Yeah, but here's what I've said. Here's what I've said. Impeach 45. Impeach 45. Impeach 45. I've said that we need the information. We need to connect the dots. We need the facts in order to do the impeachment. Impeach 45. Impeach 45. Impeach 45.
Oh, that's so terrible.
Did you hear about the DNC holding a big meeting, big rally, big pep rally? And I don't know who it was that was at the top, at the front, at the podium, but put his middle fingers in the air.
Oh.
And had the crowd do the same thing.
That's so classy.
And chanted, F Trump. F Trump.
Do they, like, cuss in front of their children? Like, when we were in D.C. the last time.
They didn't
say
the letter F. They said the bomb.
When Brian and I were in D.C., they were having the fake climate rally thingy. And we were walking through it and listening to people. And there were lots of children there. Not a majority. You know, it was just children. There were children present.
There were young ones. There were old ones. Strollers. I mean, there were all sorts of people.
Yeah. And people just randomly out of the blue would just blurt out the most vile, nasty, I'm not just saying they were saying cuss words like the F-bomb or the P-bomb or whatever, but they were saying like really nasty sexual things. Like they were just making it as bad as possible.
Oh, it was disgusting. Like if I had my wife there, I'd be like, oh, dude.
Well, then we'd
have some decorum for my wife.
Well, then we'd look around and sure enough, easily within earshot, we saw children and we're like, dude, Tone it down.
I even called one out
yeah.
in front of the kids, and I said, kids, don't listen to that potty mouth, something like yeah. that, whatever it was. But, yeah, and Vanessa just reminded me that that F Trump chant happened out in California. DNC out in California.
Oh, they're had a so big, disgusting. They have no civility whatsoever.
Not at all. And Donald J. Trump giving commencement speeches, inspiring youngins, chitlins all over America. Was at the Air National Guard something or other.
Way to help us out there, Mr. Producer.
And here's what he had to say.
Never, ever, ever give up. Things will work out just fine. Look at the way I've been treated lately. Especially by the media. No politician in history. And I say this with great surety.
I had to look that up.
Has been treated worse or more unfairly. You can't let them get you down. You can't let the critics and the naysayers get in the way of your dreams.
That I'm telling you, that is why, folks, you got to understand me when I say this about leadership, reading leadership books. Carrie and I, that's oh, what yeah. we got in it together, and we were sharing books back and forth. We were telling each other, listen yeah, to funny. This, when, read this,
when
do
I
that.
Read, I read Guerilla Mindset because I was slated to do an interview with Mike Cernovich, and I wanted, you know, I'm the type of person that if I'm going to interview an author, I got to read his book. And I was like, yeah, this is right in line. Like, I was almost thinking to myself that he was, that he had read a, who's the
Think and Grow Rich?
No, with, not that oh, one.
Unleash the Giant Within.
Yeah. And I was like, I feel like he went to one of Anthony Robbins. What do they call those?
Dude, I did a 3-dayer with Robbins.
Wow. With it, yeah. it felt to me when I was reading,
event.
When I was reading Guerrilla Mindset, that this was the culmination of going to one of those seminars
right.
and saying, you know what? I'm going to do what he did.
Right.
And he did it. I mean, he's not at the level of your Anthony Robbins yet, but he's at the point where, I mean, I think it's safe to say that he's famous.
Yeah. No, I mean, Amazon book. It's
and he's made a good amount of money, too.
A video that somebody had made on YouTube was sent to me by a fellow political aficionado of
okay.
sorts.
All right.
Just happens to be on the other side.
Oh, the other side of the aisle, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He sent the video to me, and I'm trying to get it to play. You know how when it doesn't play right away? Or
it's probably a virus.
It started, it was on YouTube, and I was using a PC.
Oh, that's dangerous.
Yeah. So it was playing, but no sound. So I started clicking around in the video to get it to see where it started,
mm-hmm.
and I accidentally clicked towards the end. And a picture was raised up, the sound started, and it started going off. The picture had Mike Cernovich, Paul Joseph Watson, the Gateway Pundit, Jim Hoff, and a couple other guys. These neocons, these are the ones that have, it's their fault.
Alt-right.
Yeah, and they were blaming them for the Comey firing, and it wasn't. So anyways, Cernovich was called out like that in a video by somebody. So to be called out like his picture
I,
is
I
like
got called
this?
Out. I got called out in one.
Wow.
Yeah, well, I was on somebody decided to use the intro to it wasn't the intro. The guy, you know, the guy that made the song for the intro of Your Voice?
Yeah.
He made another song that I totally forgot about. It wasn't like we played it once or twice or something like that. So he took that song and he took video of us in our show reacting to each other, but in like really weird ways. And he made a composite of all the all these weird reactions, our facial reactions.
Okay.
And it made it look like we were not liking the song. And I was in it. And I was like, so I felt great, man. I really did. He thought that I would be like, oh, and be really insulted by this. But let me tell you something. When you get made fun of by a completely random stranger like that.
Dude, that's a huge,
oh, it's a huge,
huge props.
Huge compliment.
However, yeah. for those of you who like us, and I know you do, don't make fun of me, man.
Low self-esteem, man. Low self-esteem. So, don't make me cry.
So this is a soundbite I wanted to play for you last week as well. This goes along with Trump. Trump, the leader that he is, Trump has read these books. He knows the Think and Grow Rich. He knows the Anthony Robbins. He knows the Secret.
Mm-hmm.
He knows those things. He's delved into those things. He's been taught. He's been raised. I mean, you just don't do what he does. What was your analogy? You take $100 and turn it into...
Oh, yeah. This isn't an analogy. This is a mathematical fact. Everybody makes fun of him about becoming somebody that's worth $10 billion, which is a lot of money.
Your daddy gave it to you.
Yeah. Oh, your dad. Yeah. Anybody become $10 billion.
Give me $1 million loan.
So he got $1 million loan, and they made a big deal about him saying it was a small loan, $1 million for my dad. And then he took that, and now he's worth $10 billion. So I decided to do a little math on that. Turning $1 million into $10 billion is the mathematical equivalent of turning $100 into $1 million.
If I gave you a $100 bill, turn that $100 into $1 million.
First of all, what would you think of a person who was able to do that? That they certainly must have earned it. They did something right.
Well, yeah, like Ray Reynolds.
What? Oh, that's a little insider for a little inside joke for you people out there listening. Yeah. So Ray Reynolds turned $1 million, turned nothing into $1 million.
Yeah. Yeah. Corporate credit. Yeah.
But he's also in prison right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's in blank pounding prison. Anyway.
So yeah, take $100. What would you do with it to make it into $1 million?
And how many, like, how often would somebody that you did that to be successful, and how many of them would be unsuccessful? It'd be astronomical how many people would fail to turn $100 into $1 million. Well, Donald Trump, within his lifetime, to be able to turn $1 million into $10 billion is exactly mathematically equivalent. It's exactly the same thing.
So here's Trump from a couple weeks ago that I wanted to play.
Is no one has ever achieved anything significant without a chorus of critics standing on the sidelines explaining why it can't be done.
True.
Nothing is easier or more pathetic than being a critic, because they're people that can't get the job done.
That is at a commencement speech in, I believe, Virginia somewhere, to some Utes. These are truths. If we listened to Susan Rice worth $50 million. Yeah, I know Susan Rice. I know. I don't want to go down that road of how she made that $50 million. But no, these youths, they're not being taught properly the secret, which is more riches have been gained by the thoughts in a man's mind than have been ever begotten from a bank, or stealing, or robbing, or physical monies. There is more, and it starts in your mind, and you've got to come up with the idea. And then you've got to take that and put that into play. These stupid little things right now, the spinners.
Have you seen these fidget spinners.
Fidget spinners?
Yeah, did you hear the real story about that?
Chick got one caught in her throat.
How?
That's had to go huge. To the hospital, get surgery.
Oh, because sometimes they are smaller. Hey, real quick, what did you hear about the fidget spinners?
No.
Oh, it's so sad. Somebody got a patent for it, couldn't get it going, let the patent expire. Now it's blown up.
Oops. Timing is everything.
Speaking of critics, I got one for you.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
God bless you, Carrie.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Pro Sports Heckler Guy. They say those who can't play coach. Apparently those who can't coach sit 30 rows back, shirtless, shouting obscenities. Thanks to you, our team is armed with game-winning tips like catch the ball and throw it.
Shout it out now.
You stink. That sucks. What a bunch of losers. Not just catcalls, but subtle psychological ploys to prod your team to victory. Psychology. So here's to you, oh Sultan of Shouting, because while there may be no I in team, thanks to you, there's always an F and a U.
But like beer, and I suppose it was. Oh my gosh. So good. So good. Was that timely or what?
That was timely. Man, I forgot about those commercials.
Oh my god.
Those were the best commercials ever.
That was my favorite out of all of them though. So, yeah. The sports heckler guy.
Cuz you've brought that up many, many times. You have said
I've actually said
to me and in public for those who can't play, coach.
And for those that can't coach, sit 30 rows up screaming obscenities. Oh, my favorite.
Real men of genius.
Yes.
There you go, Bud Light. Hey, you can send that check to P.O. Box, Walla Walla, Washington.
Just send us a six-pack. We're good to go.
Of something.
Miller. Oh, yikes.
I'm taking Amber. Anyway, hey, you want to get in just real quick? We're going to wrap it up real fast. Immigration. What do you think about this? Colorado governor on Friday pardoned a Cuban immigrant for an armed robbery he committed 19 years ago in an effort to stave off the man's deportation after immigration authorities detained him following a judge's ruling that he should no longer be in prison. Okay, here's what happened. John Hickenlooper, governor, pardoned him. He's a Democrat. This guy came over from Cuba,
mm-hmm,
on a boat.
So he would be illegal, right?
Well, once you touch soil, the law was you're here and you're here to stay.
That doesn't make any sense. Okay. That would be like saying if I cross the Mexican border.
The refugees. That's the law. I don't know.
Oh, because of Cuba?
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
I can't do anything about
you're
that.
You're a Cuban refugee if you reach the soil.
Correct.
Okay.
So apparently he got on the boat and he made it here. That's very important to remember that. He touched the sand. He made it here as a child. When he was 19, he committed armed robbery with a rifle and was sentenced to 80 years in prison.
Wow.
It was huge amounts of prison time. In 2007, 08, 09, he was accidentally set free. He was let go.
Accidentally?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then they said, no, we got to get you. No, you got to come back. So they take him back. Oh, while he was set free, had a woman, wife, got married, had kids, had a job. They said, nah, man, you shouldn't have been let go. So they put him back in prison. Okay.
Makes sense. Okay.
So this judge lets him out because this is just wrong for us to take you, put you back in. Oh, that's just so draconian. That's what he called it, draconian. So they let him out. Well, as soon as they let him out, Carrie, ICE picked him up.
Makes sense.
And you're like, why?
I mean, if he's a refugee, that's a little confusing.
Obama, remember this before he left office? And I brought it up. I said it was just awful what he did. He, with a pen and a pencil, got rid of that touch the sand you're in.
Oh, really?
Which means he ain't in no more.
Okay, okay.
And technically he's illegal, and he's committed a felonious, a crime of grand proportions to be sent to 80 years in prison. And so ICE picks him up to send him back. The governor steps in and pardons his crime in order for him to stay in America.
That's terrible. ICE, it was assault, but with an assault rifle.
Right, right. And they didn't get into the details of how bad the crime was, but obviously it was bad enough for him to be sentenced to such a long period of time. Anyways, my whole point is that these Democrat governors are losing it because their voter base of illegal immigrants, their voter base is being disrupted by the Trump train, Trump immigration. We've talked about this before. People illegally crossing the border, ICE is reporting far, far way down than what it was before. The Daily Caller in New York City, ICE arrested 156 non-criminal illegal immigrants. Okay, did you hear that? ICE arrested 156 non-criminal illegal immigrants. What that means is they haven't been convicted of a crime. When you jump the border, you got to be convicted of that crime to actually be a convicted criminal. So these people haven't been convicted yet because they've been allowed to just roam freely.
That's not good.
So they picked up 156 non-criminal illegal immigrants, more than double the amount in the same time last year. Bill, I'm a communist, de Blasio. Bill de Blasio is an absolute
comrade,
full-blown comrade. In a radio interview with WNYC, he said, "It's very distressing to hear that ICE is picking up people who are law-abiding and contributing to the community. That's only going to undermine the relations that we have between our immigrants and our police and our government in general." The mayor also said, "That's not going to make anyone safe."
That's crap.
So he's saying,
liars.
You're undermining the relationship between our immigrants and our police,
which is going to make people unsafe.
Right.
So we need to let all these people that assault people with rifles, we need to let them free, or else we could be putting people in danger because of the relationship between the cops and the immigrants.
Right.
Bad.
Yep.
That's ridiculous.
And this Venezuela again, once again, I bring up Venezuela. Venezuela, the...
You love talking about Venezuela.
Number three import of America's oil comes from Venezuela. Fox Opinion on what's going on in Venezuela by John Moody. I had to bring this up because I read this to my daughters because they had to hear this. John Moody, you hit this nail right on the head. Here's John Moody talking about Venezuela and the legacy. And here's how the article, here's the legacy of Venezuela's experiment with socialism. Although I explained to my children that socialism is not a government form. It's actually the road to communism, as
right,
we talk about
right.
here mm-hmm. on the show. But he made mention that their experiment was socialism. Daily riots and protests that have resulted in 40 deaths in recent weeks at the hands of government security officials. They've been firing live ammunition at people with no weapons. Inflation estimated at 720%. Mr. Kerry, can you do me a number? If a gallon of milk cost $2 at 720% inflation, what would that gallon cost me? I'll give you a second to work that.
$14.40?
$14.
Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
A $2 gallon of milk would cost
$14.
$14.40.
Yeah. Okay. Shortages of nothing to, shortages of basic foods and medicines, an average weight loss among Venezuelans, 19 pounds, which had nothing to do with the South Beach diet. Newborn babies are put in dresser drawers at the hospital because there are no beds. Zoo animals hunted down and butchered for food by the ravenous population. And finally this week, and only at the urging of the United States, the United Nations is considering the desperate situation in what was once South America's most prosperous country before socialism sank its fangs in and sucked the economy dry.
You said they're considering the desperate situation, but what are they going to do?
Well, he asked the bus driver who runs the show now. He assumed a position, by the way, from Hugo Chavez, probably because nobody else wanted it. He assumed it.
But he could have made it a capitalist country.
But that's not what his union upbringing.
The socialists would have killed him.
Right.
It would have been like Seth Rich.
Exactly. So he asked the UN for more money. They didn't give him money. He's done a lot of things to cut ties with all different countries, and nobody wants anything to do with Venezuela now because of him, including the UN. But U.S. is saying, come on, UN, I know they did you wrong, but dagnabbit, man, these people are falling apart. So present day example of what socialism, communism, union, thug, Democrats, what it winds up being. People hunting down zoo animals for food and newborn babies being put in dresser drawers. So there you go. And Joe Biden said that Hillary wasn't a very good candidate, thinking about a 2020 run. Anthony Weiner, yes, pleading guilty to all sexting. Huma files for divorce. And the National Enquirer has a shot of Huma and Hillary Clinton fleeing the country. Didn't read the article, just thought the ad was funny. Put it up there on Twitter. You can take a look at that. It's pretty
didn't even read it.
No, I never read it. I think it's hysterical, the front pages of that. Julian Assange, all sexual assault charges dropped by the country of Sweden.
That's really big.
Free Julian.
He's angry, though. And you know what? Good for him. He's come out and said, you know what? If you think I'm going to let this go and be happy that I'm just free, you could go to hell. Because all that time that he's had to be holed up in the embassy, he couldn't see his family, his kids, or none of that. All that time. Couldn't been away from your family. Could you imagine, you know, if you have children out there?
He said 7 years, his children grew up without daddy.
That's terrible. I mean, I didn't know how old his kids were, but he's not that old. He's like 45, I think, isn't he?
Yeah, he's not old at all.
So his kids were probably pretty young when he, they were probably relatively young.
Well, obviously they knew after 7 years, if they were three, they'd be 10. They'd know why their daddy's being held on sexual, possible sexual assault charges. What never happened?
Well, I mean, apparently not if Sweden let him off the hook. It seemed right to me, like, based on everything involved, that this would have been trumped up charges.
You would think so. New York Times Square, drunken driver, drug addict attacker in the car, mowed people down. When he was arrested, he said, I wanted to kill them all. Now he's saying that he did it on purpose because he wanted help.
He wanted help?
Yeah. Oh, he wanted the cops to shoot him.
Yeah, suicide by cop is what somebody reported. There's a lot of people that are my friends that I won't mention their names have been saying that this is really fishy.
It does reek of fish oil. It does. I'm not sure. He's got a Hispanic name.
I don't even
remember. Rojos or Rojas.
No idea. I've never even heard his name, which I think is good. I think when it comes to terrorism or lashing out like this, back in the 90s, it was the government and journalists' policy to not give the spotlight to people who do wrong because there'll be copycats or, you know, people in the future thinking, well, I can amount to something if I do something horrific and I'll get my picture and name all over the media. That's gone out the window. 9/11 pretty much ended that.
Right.
You know, it used to be you never knew anything about the terrorists at all, not his name, not his picture, anything, when something would happen. And then 9/11 happened, and they were so freaked out that they wanted to find these people and all that, but they really just made them famous, and then everything went out.
Cincinnati made national news this week.
Yeah, I saw that. What a moron. So, by the way, Mayor Cranley.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, fake crocodile tears. So the Mayor Cranley, first of all, is an idiot. Brian and I had a firsthand view of what kind of a sociopathic moron this guy is.
I called him out, texting on his phone while I was talking to him.
He wasn't even looking at Brian when he was doing his speech. And you know what? When you called him out, he looked up. And ever since then, for the whole rest of the time, he didn't do that. But when we were testifying in front of him, he not just us, it was everybody before us too, he would not even look them in the eye. He wouldn't even look in their direction. So Brian called him out. But anyway, so guy's an idiot. So back in the day, there was an officer, Kim, who was murdered in the line of duty by some Black Lives Matter guy.
It was during the campaign. It was just a year and some change ago.
Yeah, and it was during the time when George Soros was paying Black Lives Matters to perform terrorist acts, including killing as many cops as they could. It happened in Dallas, Texas, and all these different places. Well, it also happened in Cincinnati, where Officer Kim was mistaken as a white man, a white officer. Turns out he was of Asian descent. Was assassinated, gunned down in cold blood, by a Black Lives Matter guy. And they actually both shot at the same time and they both died, which is really, really rare.
It's odd. It's very odd, rare. Yeah.
So they both killed each other. But Cincinnati decided to honor the guy that killed Kim. And how did that happen?
With a day. City Council gave a day of the year to honor Tad Day, to honor this killer. They killed the cop.
Cop killer, right.
Yeah. And Mayor Cranley signed off on it. How did it happen? All city member council members are all liberal flaming Democrats. Was it a mistake?
Were they trying to honor Kim and they just got the names flipped?
No, man.
What? No, well, man. They ended up retracting it.
Right. Well, not only that, but the other thing is that there are 60 people running for mayor in Cincinnati. I believe two or three are Republican.
Yeah, that's going to be a problem.
We got a problem here in Cincinnati.
Yeah, Hamilton County's a problem now.
It ain't working out.
Yeah. We'll get that together for you. We'll fix it for you.
Fast 3 hours you're going to spend anywhere in your entire life here on Smith Radio. Share it, like it, tell a friend, tell a buddy.
And come back next week.
See ya.
With unfathomable power.
What kind of power?
Unfathomable. It's without fathom. Wow. Yeah.